What's up, guys? It's Raynad back, finally, with my Journey to N'Goro set review. I know what you're thinking. Raynad, it's been like a week since the set came out. More importantly, where did you pick up that awesome t-shirt? Well, the Temple Storm store just got a bunch of new shirts in stock. Really cool stuff. Check it out. Use code TEMPO to save some money. Aside from that, though, the reason my set review is not out at the time that I wanted it to be out is because I had a trip overlapping with the time that they revealed all the cards and when the set came out. So I originally wanted to record it right after all the cards got revealed so that, you know, I had all the information to color my opinions and to base my review off of like usual. And I also wanted to record it before the set actually came out. The cards were revealed and the set came out while I was overseas, I couldn't basically record it until, you know, more recently. So I flew back. It was already 2 days since N'Goro had been released, and I immediately recorded a new set review, and I spent 4 hours on it. It was such a good review. It was like the best video I'd ever made. I was just nonstop talking, high energy. Really, I put so much work into that video. I couldn't like talk for a day afterwards because it really kills your throat when you talk that much in like a loud, energetic voice for 4 hours nonstop. It's like a filibuster, you know? But whatever. Point is, the video file got corrupted. I ran out of hard drive space in the middle of it. I deleted some stuff, but it ended up corrupting the file, but it wouldn't tell me it was corrupted until the recording was finished. So point is, here I am re-recording it, disheartened. On one hand, you know, the review isn't out as early as I wanted it to be, but on the other hand, you get kind of a different review where, you know, I've had a couple days to play with the cards and can kind of give you a more, I guess, accurate assessment on some things. I'll try to point out where my opinions kind of changed on cards. So I'm going to go through it class by class. We're going to start off with Druid, and I'm going to try to knock this out in under 4 hours because I physically cannot take that again. So first of all, Druid. We got the 2-drop, Tortolan Forager. Love this card. 2-mana 2/2 with a card draw effect. I always compare these types of cards to Novice Engineer Loot Hoarder. On this card, these stats are very clearly too good. Like, the stats are just nuts. And on my first impression, I was like, well, I can include this in just about any aggro deck I want. I mean, a 2-mana 2/2 is par for the course for 2-drops now, just stat-wise. And when you're drawing a card off of it, that's just a massive, massive impact. I mean, obviously, if you're playing the Druid quest, you're going to be including Tortolan Forager, which is a card I probably should have reviewed first. I'll review that after this card. But outside of the quest decks, even, you can consider this in ramp. You can consider this in just any aggro deck. And it's just a really powerful, high powerful card. That was my first impression, right? After having played with it a little bit more, I realized that in the like hyper aggressive decks, that where the curve tops out at like 4 or 5, a lot of times this card is a little bit more questionable. You'd rather have something with higher stats because you're not going to have time to play your like 9-drop in a lot of games. But in other games, it does just outright win you a game that's kind of back and forth. So overall, still incredibly high power level card. Whether it's good enough to see an inclusion in like ramp decks and maybe even jade decks, I tried this in. It's just, it has a lot of flexibility because the power level is so high, but I think mostly we'll see it in the quest druid decks, if those are a thing, and we'll see it in the like all-in ramp decks with some of the new tools for ramp. And yeah, other than that, it's just a high power level 2-drop. I expect to see more and more of this guy as more expansions come out into the standard format. Next, I'm going to move on to the quest. I probably should have reviewed this first. I'll review the quest as the first card in the future classes as well. But Jungle Giants, right? It's the first quest I'm going to review. I mean, it's a quest that wants you to play 5 minions with 5 or more attack, and the reward is Barnabas. And what Barnabas is going to do is he's a 5-mana 8/8 beast, and he's going to reduce the cost of minions in your deck to 0. So the important thing here is he reduces them in your deck to 0, not your deck and hand. If you reduce the cost of stuff in your hand, obviously you could just play him, empty your hand the turn you drop him, and that's kind of an insurmountable board state that just wins you the game. As is, the card is definitely a lot weaker than that. Imagine you draw a spell for the first card off of this. It just feels a little bit underwhelming sometimes. But more importantly, the reason I think this the quest is weak is just the condition is so hard to fill. There aren't enough cheap 5-mana dudes that you want to be playing Jungle Giants in your deck, right? When you keep a quest in your deck, it has to be really reliable. Like, when you keep it in the beginning of the game, it has to be super reliable that it's going to trigger, because you're going down a card to keep it, and that card isn't affecting the board, Right. That card is just a massive, it lowers your chances massively of having a good curve. So, point is, there's really high opportunity cost to keeping a quest. Quest has to be pretty reliable to go off. Jungle Giants, right? Against the aggro, you're not going to want to keep this. Against the aggro, it's just too slow. The ward doesn't do anything for you. It doesn't have taunt. You just play it, and then they kill you. So you're really playing it in kind of this mid-rangey, aggressive druid deck. And even though Blizzard gave us a lot of new tools for this type of quest, I don't think it's quite there to be competitive. But the condition is broad enough. There's enough five attack minions in the game that I think, as expansions come out, this card's going to be a lot stronger. Just like all the quests, every card gets stronger as expansions come out. But this is definitely a case of like, if there's just a couple more cheap five attack guys that are worth playing, this card becomes absurd. So now, as far as the five attack tools that Blizzard gave us, we got Elder Longneck, which I'm going to review next, right? It's a 3-mana 5/1 battle cry. If you're holding a minion with five or more attack, adapt. So this is an incredibly powerful 3-drop. Like, this card is so good in the deck that you put it in. Now, despite that though, like, just in a vacuum, right? When you adapt it, I mean, this can be an 8/1, it can be a 5/1 Divine Shield. Compare that to like Scarlet Crusader that's seen competitive play when I put it in Zoo. Think about like giving it 3 extra health. It's a 3-mana 5/4, it's still not bad. What about a 3-mana 5/1 that summons 2 plants? Like, these are all like really above the curve 3-drops, right? And it has Beast Synergy. This card is like stupidly powerful in a vacuum. But because the quest deck is kind of, I think, weak, just because it has no good 1-drop, it just, there's a number of reasons I think it's weak, but it's basically just missing. It reminds me of Beast Druid back in the day. It's just missing like a lot of tools that it needs. Because that deck won't be too common, I think Elder Longneck might also not be too common, right? Like, in a ramp deck, you're not really going to want to keep this card as much because you're going to want to look for your ramp spells. And if you draw your ramp spells, you're not going to, playing this guy on turn, like, with 4 mana available is not too impressive. And then you're going to be using cards to ramp, so you're probably not going to have a 5-attack minion. You don't want to keep your expensive stuff. So, point is, I think the card is strong. I think the deck for it isn't quite there, though. Moving on, we got Spellshifter, which is the final strong tool that Blizzard gave us for the Jungle Giants deck. So this 4-drop is in a long line of stupidly powerful choose one druid 4-drops. First of all, it can just be Sengen Shieldmaster. Powerful, obviously. Great against aggro. But then the other side of it is something we haven't seen before, which is a 4-mana 5/3 stealth, which is so powerful. Like, the fact that I have this 4-drop threat with good on-curve stats that you just can't interact with as a control deck. I can just bank that stealth until I play Savage Roar. I can just bash you right away. I can just stealth it and then copy it on turn 6. It triggers Jungle Giants. Like, the fact that you have the choice between these two abilities just makes this such a powerful 4-drop, one of the strongest 4-drops the Druid has access to in Standard. And yeah, just a very powerful card for the more mid-rangey, more aggressive Druid decks. I mean, there might even be a point where we're playing it in the more ramp-oriented ones, although the ramp decks don't really need to stealth as often. We'll see if that actually happens. But point is, just a powerful card, and I'm a big fan of it. Actually, I just may have made a mistake. If you stealth it, I don't know that it actually is a beast. Don't hold me to that. I should have researched. One of those like little things. I should have researched. There's just so many cards in the expansion. It's possible you can't Menagerie Ward in this. I don't remember what it turns into. Probably some kind of turtle thing. Anyway, good card. I don't think it's enough to make the Jungle Giants deck work. If we had like a couple more of these cards at every point in the curve, I think that deck would be pretty strong though. All right. So moving on, we got Verdant Longneck, which is a 5-mana, 5/4 Battlecry Adapt. So if I want a, how do I put this? Okay, basically, when I first saw the card revealed, I thought that the adapt mechanic wasn't that strong, and I thought, okay, well, this card is just overcosted for most of the things that you're going to get out of it. At this point, I'm still kind of that opinion, right? The fact that it has 5 attack lets you play this in a Jungle Giant deck when you can't quite play Druid of the Claw for that reason. But compared to Druid of the Claw, compared to Stranglethorn Tiger, you're really, really most of the time getting a worse 5-drop, right? There's certain effects that are really strong on this. For example, the extra health can be pretty powerful. But yeah, overall, Verdant Longneck is a pretty underpowered card. Don't expect this to see much play. I think you're going to play Stranglethorn Tiger for the Menagerie Warden synergy. I think you're going to play Druid of the Claw just in a mid-range deck that's not playing Jungle Giants because it's just higher power level. Yeah, even things like Harrison Jones is contends with. I think it's just better 5-drop options. But we'll see. You never know. Maybe it sees play. I think Bittertide Hydra is another card that really competes with this too. The 5-mana 8-8. So yeah, overall, not too impressed. Next, we got Earthen Scales. Give a friendly minion 1-1 and then gain armor equal to its attack. So this card is a spell I really don't like. It does two things, right? First of all, being a cheap buff is the kind of effect you want in an aggressive deck, because when you already have board control and you already have minions in play, the +1/+1 effect is going to help you get a trade that your opponent wasn't accounting for. It's going to help you continue to snowball the board. It's just going to be really powerful. Now, the armor effect is something that a control deck wants, because you want to just not die to burn, right? You're slow. You want to be able to stabilize after your opponent's gotten an early lead. So in an aggro deck, it's not good enough, because if you lose board control, gaining armor isn't going to win you the game. You've already lost the game. So the armor effect is useless in an aggro deck. And then in control, the +1/+1 effect is useless. And some people think they can use this card, and are using it in the past couple days I've seen, to just like, they'll play it in like a ramp deck, and they'll play it on a big guy to gain a bunch of life. But I don't think that's good at all, because you can't play it when you have an empty board. It's just healing touch, basically. Sure, it costs less mana, but you're usually also gaining less life. And you wouldn't really play healing touch in a ramp deck most of the time anyway, except in certain metas. So long story short, I think this card is just a classic example of a card trying to do two different things for two different decks. And the two decks are just so wildly different that you're always missing out on 50% of the value, no matter what deck you put this in. So I'm really unimpressed with this card. I don't expect it to see much play. Moving on, we've got Evolving Spores. Evolving Spores is essentially the same power level as Soul of the Forest. Soul of the Forest is a card that's seen competitive play, very powerful in token druid decks, powerful with Violet Teacher. I would say Evolving Spores is better on average. Soul of the Forest is strong against AoE and everything, but Evolving Spores does let you just kill your opponent sometimes as a Bloodlust effect. It's definitely higher variance. It's an interesting card. I think Evolving Spores is something I'm going to be keeping an eye out on. If Token Druid takes off, it's something I'm probably going to run. But really, it's Soul of the Forest level of power, so at the end of the day, it's not really going to change how the deck operates or how it's built. It just might be a cool one of tech inclusion. All right, next we got a really interesting one. We've got Living Mana. So this 5-mana card, right, transforms all your mana crystals into 2-2 minions. The 2-2 minions have Death Rattle, recover a mana crystal. So this card I love. It's what this card reminds me of is like, or the way to use it, I think, is kind of like Fel Reaver back in Aggro Druid. There is literally a new 5-mana 8-8 beast in this expansion for aggro decks, but I think this card is better in Aggro Druid than that card. And I said that in my original review too. Living Mana is a card that's really interesting because it lets you all in after you've emptied your hand and just kind of spent the early game vomiting your stuff, getting control of the board, getting some damage in. Okay, now they managed to wipe your stuff with a swipe and everything. You have this one single card, this one 5-mana card, that just wins you the game on its own some amount of the time, right? Just like Fel Reaver. It's not going to win you the game every time, right? But it's a very powerful plan B. And one other really cool synergy is I found Hemet to be really strong in a deck like that as well, because then immediately after Hemet, you're drawing Living Mana half the time, going all in. Like, it's just powerful because it's a singular card that gives you 10 attack of multiple minions. It's hard to interact with. Like, single target removal isn't going to work against it. And because it's just a single card that can win you the game, it's just a really good final, I don't know what the word is, you know, it's just a final last stand against decks when you draw it in your aggro list. Now, outside of aggro lists, in more control-oriented decks or ramp-oriented decks, this card sucks. Like, you should not be trying to combo this with the Death Rattle doubler guy on turn 9 or anything like that. That's stupid, it sucks, it's not going to work. But as just an aggro finisher where, you know, you vomit dudes, you kill some stuff, okay, they've almost stabilized and just slam Living Mana and they die next turn. As that kind of tool, I think it's very powerful. So Keep an eye out for this card in Aggro Druid. Alright, next we got Giant Anaconda. Death Rattle, summon a minion from your hand with 5 or more attack. This card really shows you how disgusting Voidcaller was and still is. Well, Voidcaller is like one of the strongest cards in WoW, I still think. Love how many mistakes Nick Schramm has had. But even though this card's weaker than Voidcaller, it's not entirely unplayable. Now, I don't think you want to be running this with Tyrantus, which is the card I'm going to review next. Necessarily, I don't think you're just putting this in your aggressive deck trying to randomly get a 12-12 off of it. But in a ramp deck, it's actually a pretty interesting 7-drop. There's definitely a lot of, or a couple new interesting tools for ramp decks, especially in the neutrals that I'll talk about later, that let you kind of include this as a 7-drop that puts a lot of pressure on against control, even against aggro, can cheese into play some stuff a lot sooner than you should be able to. And I think that for a ramp deck, we've never really had a card of this kind of effect. So it's going to take some time to see just how powerful it is, to see if it really has a place in those decks. But I think that even though I don't see myself playing it in mid-range or aggressive decks, it definitely has a place in ramp where you're like almost always going to get a big dude off of it. It's interesting to consider whether this card is strong, and if so, how strong is it? So what's the best thing to cheat into play off Giant Anaconda? Well, probably a Shard or something, but Tyrantus, the card I'm going to review next, is not bad either. It's a 10 mana 12-12. It's a big, stupid fairy dragon. It's a beast and stuff. You can't target it. It has some flavor text. It's blue. It doesn't look very big in the artwork. It's like my one complaint about it. I mean, the card is big and stupid and cool. So what is there to say about it? You know, it's not a card I want to be paying 10 mana for. And I don't think it's a card that's really going to create its own archetypes in Constructed. I don't think it's really going to push any archetype into the forefront on its own. But I think in your cheesy Astral Communion type decks without Astral Communion, you know, the hyper ramp decks with Giant Anaconda, this could be a role player card. So overall, it's cool. It's flashy. I don't expect it to make too much of an impact in Constructed outside of very niche decks. So moving on next, we got Hunter. So Hunter is a deck that was really struggling with getting early game board control because the Patches decks all had early game weapons and Hunter didn't have Glaivezuka. If Hunter just had Glaivezuka, it would have been a tier 1 or tier 2 deck because it would have been able to contest Pirates and Aggro Shaman's early game a little bit better. Anyway, the biggest buff Hunter got in this expansion is not with the cards I'm about to review, it's with the fact that Tunnel Trog and Totem Golem rotated out. Those are cards this class just could not beat with random 1-mana 1-1s and 2-1s in board control specific matchups or board control centered matchups. But now you don't have to contend with those things. The early game in every deck is just pretty weak at this point. And you know, strongest card in, or the strongest early game card in the game is like Jade Claw now. So these minions are not that bad against it. And I think just the stuff rotating out is going to help Hunter a lot more than the stuff coming in. Anyway, I'm going to start with the quest like I should for every class. The Marsh Queen. So, quest, play 7 one-cost minions, reward Queen Karnassa. So, this is a card that in my initial review I said, we'll see if it's decent. It's either like really good or really bad. There's really no in-between. I can't say whether it's really good or really bad right now. I can say after having played with the card for a couple hours, I can definitively say this card is complete and utter trash. Dust it at the first chance you get. It's so unplayable in any possible iteration you can think of. This card is an embarrassment to quests. This thing could be like play 5 one-cost minions, and I think it would still suck. This card is just one of the worst Hearthstone cards they've made in a long time, and I'm saying that in a world where we have things like Pompous Thespian. Not a big fan of Marsh Queen at all. Just dust it. That's one of those cards that, like, before the review, I wasn't sure. Like, in my original review, I wasn't sure how good it would be, and now I'm very sure of how good it is, which is not at all. Anyway, we got Jeweled Macaw as the next card I'm going to review. A new iteration of Web Spinner. I think the interesting thing about Jeweled Macaw is it really shows that Blizzard doesn't want to do reprints in new expansions, because they could have just made Web Spinner. It would have made sense with the Death Rattle guy they printed as well. It's a card Blizzard has said they already like a lot. But instead they decided to just give it Battle Cry. So it's like mostly the same card, but not a direct reprint and doesn't have Death Rattle synergy. Overall, I think Jeweled Macaw is high power level card, just like Web Spinner was. You know, you're not going to get the Death Rattle synergy, but it doesn't matter too much. You're just going to play it as a one mana guy that replaces itself, sort of, and be pretty happy with that. I mean, you just want stuff to do to fill in your curve. This card does it fine. We've seen Web Spinner be solid for years. This card will be solid. Moving on to an exceptional card, maybe the best card that Hunter got in this expansion. Actually, definitely the best card. We got Crackling Razor Maw. So this 2-drop is busted. 2-mana Battlecry Adapt a Friendly Beast is so gross. Like, Adapt is a super powerful effect. It's worth a mana, essentially, just a little bit less than a mana. This card is just way above the power curve. It does have to be a beast, whatever you're adapting, so you can't just put in whatever 1-drops you have because they're good. But the snowball potential of this in the early game is just so sick. Like, you kill your opponent so quickly. Adapt as a mechanic is a lot stronger than I thought it would be, and I already knew this was going to be one of the best Hunter cards when they showed it. But this card is just, yeah, absolutely, you know, I said it was nuts in my original review. I've played with it for like a day. I can confirm it is nuts. Just play this card as a 2-of. It's really, really good. All right, next we got Grievous Bite. 2-mana spell, deal 2 damage to a minion, 1 to adjacent ones. We haven't really had a removal spell like this before. It's definitely a card that's there to help you win the early game board control fight in the more tempo-oriented matchups. It's actually kind of a high skill level card. I like that this is in the game because in some cases you'll be able to... Like, the difference between good players and great players will be like... The great players will play around Grievous Bite with their positioning sometimes. Like, that's always kind of cool. It's a tough card to evaluate, even after it's been out for a day or two. I haven't personally played that much Hunter, maybe a few games. I was just memeing people with the quest. Grievous Bite is just a tough one to evaluate, right? We haven't had removal like this before, but I think the potential's there. I think comparing it to something like Power Shot isn't too out of the question, and Power Shot's a pretty solid card, honestly. Power Shot's a card that would have seen play in any other class a lot more, but yeah, Grievous Bite has some synergy with things like Hunter's Mark and all of that, but overall, just a solid card. You know, obviously Insane in the Mirror, not that that means much. It's a card I expect to see play in certain metas that have a lot of aggro. Against Control, it's just dead. You can't really go face with it. That's going to hurt, but yeah, solid card overall. Definitely not unplayable. What is unplayable, on the other hand, is Small Raptor, the 1-drop I'm going to review next. This is a 1-mana 2-1 beast with no text. This card is an embarrassment for Rexxar, I think. I think all the people that are like, but what about Tolvir Warden? You can get the 4-3. It's like, it's not even good. It's not even... To pay 5 mana for a 3-5, like, that can be Stranglethorn Tiger. That can be Tundra Rhino. You could kill your opponent instead of drawing 3 health minions to play on turn 6 that don't attack until turn 7 and interrupts your high main curve. Point is, I don't like Small Raptor. This card sucks. Why does it suck? Well, you don't actually ever get the 4-3. Like, just for the pure stats you're getting on board, it's a 1-mana 2-1. Doesn't do anything. Like, it loses to hero power. And then you have like a 1 in 25 chance to draw the 4-3 Raptor in a reasonable time frame. Like, it's just really underwhelming. And then even if you draw the 1-mana 4-3, it's not like you won the game. You got a slightly above average minion. Same health as Zombie Chow, basically. And then, like, you can, you can't even play it the first turn you draw it sometimes. Because if you draw it, let's say you draw it, like on your second turn, you'd rather play Animal Companion still. And what if you have, like, Houndmaster or the Piloted Wolf? Like, what are you going to do? You're not going to play your 4-3 for a while. The point is, the payoff's not that good or that likely. The stats suck. This card sucks. The quest sucks, so that's not a reason to play it either. All right, moving on, we got Terror Scale Stalker. 3-mana, 3-3, Battlecry, trigger, friendly minions, Death Rattle. I think this card's also pretty underwhelming. I think that the Kindly Grandmother synergy is pretty sick because you... don't want to kill off your opponent's Kindly Grandmother on turn 2, so that'll go off pretty often if you are playing this card. But when you don't draw Kindly Grandmother, it's just going to be really underwhelming. It's a card that just doesn't look that powerful to me. I'd rather just get all my stats up front. I think that Blizzard has historically overcosted this kind of effect with things like Feign Death or Princess Huhurin. I think cards like this need to not lose stats in order to gain this effect to be good. Like, if this card... If this card was a 3-4, it would be a very different story. I think it would be insane, but it's not. And you can compare it to things like Unearthed Raptor, for example, just to really show how weak it is overall. All right. So moving on, we got Tolvir Warden at the 5-mana slot. I mean, a lot of people really hype up this card and think it's good. I think this card sucks. I think you're giving up so many stats just to get the Battle Cry. Like, you can have +2 attack. That's worth a card, basically, or like half a card. I don't know. It's like an adaptation, right? You can have +2 attack, plus stealth. You can adapt your minion twice by playing Stranglethorn Tiger compared to Tolvir Warden. Hearthstone's a tempo-oriented game. I'd rather just kill my opponent than draw 1-mana 4-3s. But you're not even going to draw 1-mana 4-3s. You're going to draw, like, Web Spinner. This card is just really low impact for 5-mana. I would rather play Tundra Rhino. I would rather play Stranglethorn Tiger. My 5-drop needs to kill them. This card doesn't kill them. I'm not a fan. And it's not nearly enough to make the quest playable. Alright, so moving on, we got Stampede. Each time you play a beast this turn, add a random beast to your hand. So the lock and load type of cards have definitely shown to not see too much play historically in Hearthstone. Stampede is interesting because it only costs 1 mana, which we haven't really seen an effect like that before. There have definitely been some busted cards like this in Magic the Gathering, such as Glimpse of Nature, but that's a game where you draw a card from your deck. You don't get a random beast every time you play a beast. So even though it feeds itself the way that Lyra feeds itself, a priest card that I'll talk about coming up, it's not enough to make this good, I think. I think you're paying 1 mana for like 2 random beasts most of the time. In order to make a really broken Stampede, you have to be playing a Hunter deck with a lot of low-cost beasts. And decks like that, as I tried them, they're just really linear. They don't have too much flexibility the way mid-range Hunter does. It's really tough to put a bunch of cheap beasts into your deck without sacrificing card quality. So I think Stampede is going to not see that much play moving forward, unfortunately, but it's a card that I think shows they're getting closer to the right casting cost on certain effects. I think 1 mana is appropriate for this card. I think it's 0 mana, it would be too good. So yeah, it's just a little bit underpowered. Don't expect to see this too much. And I think Hunter is going to gravitate more towards the mid-range type of strategy, just because that's just your best chance of winning, is running a build like that. All right, next we got Dinomancy. Your hero power becomes give a beast +2/+2. It's pretty interesting. I think in other classes, changing the hero power is a lot more powerful than in Hunter, because Hunter, in a vacuum, I would say, has the most powerful hero power in the game. I think that the way Hearthstone plays out, the way classes interact with each other, Hunter hero power is just the only hero power in the game that wins you the game on its own. And it's just so damn strong. I mean, when I say the Hunter hero power is so strong in relation to Dinomancy, what that means is that when you change your hero power to make it better by spending a card, by spending 2 mana to not affect the board, you're not upgrading your hero power that much. I mean, giving her a beast +2/+2 is definitely stronger if you just started the game with that, but you don't. You give up a spot in your curve. Like, instead of playing a 2-drop, I'm playing Dinomancy. Instead of playing a 4-drop, I'm playing Dinomancy and activating it, or playing a 2-drop. You're losing a lot of tempo to switch out your hero power, and it's not that much of an upgrade, right? In a lot of situations, you'd rather actually have the Hunter hero power in the late game to just kill your opponent. So Dinomancy overall, really sketchy card. It's tough to build your deck around it, because if you Dinomancy a second time, it doesn't get any better. It's not like Shadow Form. So drawing a second Dinomancy is pretty annoying. Yeah, it's just generally a pretty just underpowered card, I would say, and I don't expect it to see too much play. But yeah, maybe at some point we have enough early game beasts and there's a strategy for this, but I don't think that time is now. And finally we got Swamp King Dread, who's a 7-mana 9/9. After your opponent attacks a minion, attack it. So as far as 7-drops go, they're really tough to justify putting in your deck, because when you're playing Hunter, you have so many other strong late game options, right? You can already play 2 high mains. You can just play like a couple more 5-drops. And that's a curve that's mostly not going to run out of cards for the first 20 turns of the game. So when you're playing a 7-drop, it really has to do a lot in order to be worth the slot. It's like Dr. Boom won you the game on its own. That was worth the slot. This card is not Dr. Boom power level, Nor is it Ragnaros power level. You don't have that immediate kill your opponent aspect to it. But it is a 7 mana 9/9. And is that enough to justify putting this in a mid-range hunter deck? Well, I don't think so. I think you'd rather have more tools just because there's so many things you want to fit into hunter. You want to fit in a good curve. You want to fit in some taunts with Houndmaster. You want to fit in burn. You want to fit in like a couple secrets sometimes. You want to fit in just so many things that it's really tough to fit in a random 7-mana idiot. I think you would play both Savannah High Mains before you ever play this guy. And you would rather, basically what I'm saying is Swamp King Dread will never make it into your deck until you already have two High Mains. So this is like High Main number three, and it's like a worse one. Now that still might be good enough in some metas. It's still a really big, powerful minion. It's weak to things like Execute, but there isn't too much powerful single target removal. It's weak to Hex as well, but so is High Main. They're not gonna have Hex for everything. It's an interesting card. I think it's not unplayable. I think it's definitely something we might see a decent amount of, especially in a world with a lot of dirty rats right now. But overall, I'd say it's on the lower end of the spectrum as far as power level is concerned. I'd say this card's not that strong in a vacuum, but it's a cool effect. Reminds me of that one orange dinosaur Digimon. I don't know. It's a cool card. We'll see if it sees much play. I think as expansions come out, it'll see less and less play though. All right, so that's about it for Hunter. We'll see how it shakes out compared to other classes. I'm gonna move on to Mage next, and I'm gonna start off with Open the Waygate, which is a really fun card. Cast six spells that didn't start in your deck. Reward Time Warp. I love effects like this. These are some of my favorite decks to play in other card games that have these kinds of effects. And Blizzard gave us a lot of tools for ways to add spells to your hand that didn't start in your deck. Time Warp effect, you usually are thinking, okay, well, I want to use this in an OTK list with Arcane Giant and stuff like that. For the most part, I think that is how the card will get used. The real question is, do you build it like as a combo deck? Do you try to work this into like a tempo deck with a lot of random card draw elements? That's where it gets a little bit questionable, right? Six spells, as it turns out, is quite a bit, right? It's not just a matter of playing a Cabalist Tome. You have to play the Cabalist Tome, and you have to play all the spells off the Cabalist Tome, which some of them might be expensive. And you have to play some other spells. Primordial Glyph really helps, which the card I'll talk about soon in this expansion, but this is just a really hard condition to meet, and there's no guaranteed kill after time warping. If you build your entire deck in a way that's dedicated to getting this off, and you time warp with Arcane Giants, that's still going to lose to just a taunt wall from a control warrior that's like having a proactive plan. It's still very easy to get killed before that point. If you go full combo, I think Freeze Mage is just a better deck. And I think that if you integrate this into more of like a tempo deck or like a value minion deck with like Cabal Courier and Cabal Chemist and stuff like that, I think then it gets a little bit more interesting. And that's kind of the strategy I want to think about more with this deck and try out a little bit more. But overall, I'm a big fan of these kinds of effects because they're very fun, at least to play with, maybe not to play against. I hope they explore this design space a little bit more. I love that taking an extra turn is finally a thing that some card can do in Hearthstone. But I think right now with the cards that we have, at least in Standard, it's going to be just kind of a worse version of Freeze Mage, more or less, and just a little bit underpowered. Next, I'm going to talk about the strongest mage card they've released in a very, very long time. Like, in a very long time. In my original set review, I said that this card is the strongest card in the set, I think I said, or very likely to be the strongest card in the set, and I stand by that now after having seen it play out. The 2-drop is Arcanologist. 2-mana, 2/3, Battlecry, draw a secret from your deck. So it is much less broken than Mad Scientist. But it is still so broken. A 2-mana 2/3 is just great stats. A 2-mana 2/3 that draws you a card is like think about Novice Engineer, right? When Novice Engineer had 2 health, it was a 2-mana 1/2 that drew you a card. It saw play in every single deck in Standard as a 2 of, and it had to get nerfed. Arcanologist has +1/+1. You're getting good stats, and you're still drawing a card. And Arcanologist is one of those cards getting printed that single-handedly introduces new cards into the metagame that have always been around but never really saw play. So like, for example, when Mysterious Challenger came into the metagame, Secret Keeper got to see play for the first time. Well, now that Arcanologist is in the game, Medivh's Valet is going to see play for the first time, because now you can just play like a deck with four secrets and a bunch of card draw and two Arcanologists, and your Medivh's Valet is always active. I think Freeze Mage, even though they nerfed Ice Lance or they rotated it out, I think Freeze Mage might be stronger than it's ever been, because they gave it essentially three powerful tools this expansion. They gave it Arcanologist, they gave it Medivh's Valet because of Arcanologist, which, by the way, Medivh's Valet is a card that was already seeing play in Freeze Mage once in a while back in the day. Now it's just very consistent. Now you have four Frost Bolts. And on top of that, you get Primordial Glyph, which is a card I'll talk about later. It's in this expansion. So overall, all things considered, just a busted two drop. This alone is going to enable the Tempo Mage decks to be secret-based. There have been a lot of tools like Cabal Aki, Ethereal Arcanist, Cabal Crystal Runner. I talked a lot about this deck in my original review as well. I think this is really the card that pushes it over the top. You finally have a good two drop. Your mulligan decisions are finally not super hard, because now that you keep Arcanologist, you have your two drop and you get a secret for your secret enabler guys. You don't have to make this awkward decision between keeping an opening hand secret or mulling for a good curve. Arcanologist does both. It's just such a sick card. It's just S tier card. Play it if you're playing mage. Like, this alone is going to make so many secrets see play in the metagame. And I think the Tempo Secret Mage deck with Flamemaker rotating out might just end up being like the way to build Tempo Mage moving forward. We'll see. All right, next we got Flame Geyser, which is a 2-mana deal 2 damage, add a 1/2 elemental to your hand. This is a kind of effect that we haven't seen too much before, as far as, you know, deal 2 damage for 2 mana. We've seen like Demon Fires around. There's probably some I'm forgetting, but in general, we haven't been seeing a 2-mana 2 damage card that can go face or to a minion. I guess there's been Lava Shock. Now, unlike Lava Shock, this is in Mage, first of all, which cares a lot more about having cheap spells than Shaman. More importantly, it gives you an elemental, so it's actually good value. And this is really a key role player card in elemental decks. You can kind of compare it to a lot of things, right? You can compare it to Disciple of C'Thun in a way, Argent Horse Rider, where you play it turn 3 and then you play your elemental right away. It's not that different. The 1/2 elemental drop is probably stronger than, you know, a 2/1 being left behind in a lot of cases. It's a powerful card. Like, Flame Geyser kills a lot more stuff turn 2 than it used to. You know, if we were talking about Standard in the days of Naxxramas or Goblins versus Gnomes, 2 damage on turn 2 wouldn't really kill that much. But nowadays, most of the 2 drops have 2 health or 1 health. And that means that you can play this on curve, kill something off, like a Hydrologist or Knife Juggler or whatever, and then still get value off that interaction. So, pretty important. It's a big enabler for all the elemental synergy that you can kind of weave into most mage decks now. And I think even though the card doesn't seem that powerful, it's not like a game-winning card. It's like the glue that holds mage elemental decks together. Now, the case might be that those decks just never see play, and because of that, Flame Geyser never sees play. Like, it's probably not strong enough to just put in a Freeze Mage deck. Despite that, I think it is a high power level card. I think it's something that we'll see play in the elemental versions of mage decks. I think the secret elemental deck is probably not going to have room for it. The secret Tempo Mage deck is not going to have room for Flame Geyser. And I think the mage, Freeze Mage decks, the combo-oriented ones, also aren't going to have room for Flame Geyser. So whether this card sees play or not is going to be completely contingent on whether Elemental Mage sees play. Which it might not. That's just one of those things that's going to take time to see play out. The Elemental Mage deck plays a very similar tempo style to the Secret Mage deck. So if the Secret Mage deck is just like a couple percentage points better on average, then maybe the Elemental Mage deck never sees play. You can also hybridize the two. You can play Secret Elemental Mage, which is the first deck I played on stream on my first day playing the expansion, and that was pretty fun. So you can definitely like work the Elemental package into a lot of different things. But long story short, a card is solid, it's playable. The only real home it has is in Elemental decks, in Standard at least. We'll see if that's enough to see play. All right, next you got Shimmering Tempest, 2 mana, 2/1 elemental, death rattle, add a random mage spell to your hand. So when you compare this card to Babbling Brook, it is so much weaker. You're getting one extra attack, but you're paying double the mana, and it's a death rattle, not a battle cry. This is just so much weaker than Babbling Brook, just like as raw stats, before you take into account the tribal tag on it, which is elemental. So in elemental decks, you obviously have to consider it because you want to play Steam Surger, the 4-drop we'll talk about later. You want to play your other elementals, and you kind of have to, consider like, hey, is this card good enough just to enable that elemental synergy in the deck? And I think the answer for the most part is no, because as a 2-drop, you're going to want to play Arcanologist, you're going to want to play Sorcerer's Apprentice sometimes, you're going to want to play, you can just play like Flame Geyser turn 2 and kill a guy. You'd rather do that than play this thing. You just have so many other things to do on turn 2. That you don't want like a strictly worse loot hoarder just to enable elemental synergy. You also have Pyros, which I think is just a better 2 mana card than Shimmering Tempest, right? I would rather draw Boulder Fist Ogre and have an extra point of health than play this garbage. Now, it not only does it have elemental synergy, but it also has Open the Waygate synergy. But the thing about Open the Waygate, the quest, is you're not really at a shortage in standard, at least, for cards that give you spells from outside the game. Babbling Brook is gonna give you a card better than Shimmering Tempest will for Open the Waygate, and Primordial Glyph is gonna give you a card in a better way. There's just a lot of cards that are gonna, Cabalist Tome is gonna give you spells in a better way than this will. You just don't need this kind of effect. It's like your worst elemental in an elemental deck. It's your worst random spell generator in an Open the Waygate deck. I think for the most part, it's just on the lower end of the power spectrum, so it's not going to see too much play, even though it has all of the synergy and all of those strategies. It's just a little bit too weak. Right, moving on, we got Mana Bind, which is a 3 mana spell. Whenever your opponent casts a spell, add a copy to your hand that costs 0. This is a spell that's pretty tough to get. It's a spell that's tough to have be strong for you in most games because, okay, there are certain secrets that are just very powerful, like Cat Trick, for example, because at some point your opponent has to play a spell, and the payoff you get for that spell is just really strong. You get a 2-mana 4/2 stealth minion, your opponent can't really interact with it that turn, you immediately get attack and stuff. It's a good secret, right? Mana Bind is played around in the same way that Counterspell is played around, and you're only going to play Mana Bind in probably like your secret Temple Mage deck. You're not going to play this in Freeze Mage or Control. So your Mana Bind is, it's easy to play around because it's being played in the same deck that has Counterspell. It's played around the same way, and you're not guaranteed to get a good return off of playing it. So when you get a Cat Trick, you're getting a 4/2 stealth minion. That's a beast. That's great. Hunter always wants that. Every version of Hunter wants that. Mana Bind is like, let's say I get Whirlwind out of my Control Warrior opponent, or a Brawl, or like any AoE, and I'm playing this in an aggressive deck. That's just really weak, right? Countering that spell is fine because I want to stop my opponent from doing stuff. So compared to Counterspell, this card's a lot worse, but it's not going to let you do anything broken that you couldn't otherwise do. Mana Bind does have synergy with Open the Waygate, but I'm not even convinced you want to play this card in Open the Waygate. I think you'd rather have freeze effects. I think you'd rather have a lot of things before you start playing this crap. And yeah, overall, it's just a card that I'm not very impressed with. I think, again, just like with Shimmering Tempest, Mana Bind is one of the worst ways to add spells to your hand that didn't start in your deck for the sake of the quest. I think in a tempo secret mage deck, I think it doesn't affect the board and it doesn't protect your board the way Counterspell or Spellbender does. It doesn't even sit in play permanently like a secret the way Spellbender or Ice Block does. So, like, for all of those reasons, it's just a fairly underpowered card that I'm not too impressed with. And I don't expect to see too much Mana Bind being played as time goes on. But, it's kind of cool that it has synergy with Arcanologist, Open the Waygate. It's an effect we haven't seen before. I just think you're not guaranteed to be able to have good value out of the spell you get. Not too strong of a card. All right, moving on, we got Molten Reflection, which first time I saw this, I thought about Echo of Medivh, even though this is a very different effect. I think truthfully, this is more similar to Faceless Shambler and Faceless Manipulator. Those are kind of the cards you got to compare it to. It is a spell, so it's a little bit better in that regard, but it's worse than Manipulator in that you can't target your opponent's stuff, even if it is cheaper. It doesn't give your minion taunt the way that Faceless Shambler does, although this one's more immune to silence. The point is, it's another 4 to 5 mana clone effect that if it did see play, I think it would be in a combo-oriented deck. I think with Emperor Thorsen rotating out, this type of card's a lot less likely to see play. And outside of crazy Molten Giant combo or Arcane Giant combo decks, maybe Molten Giant, this won't see too much play. So I don't expect too much Molten Reflection moving forward, but it's definitely an interesting card. We'll see if it does see play down the line, but I don't expect to see too much of this thing. All right, next we got Steam Surger, and this is like the big 4-mana payoff for being an elemental mage deck, right? Steam Surger plus Flame Geyser plus Pyros is a pretty tight elemental package that you can fit into a tempo-oriented elemental deck, a slower, more controlling elemental mage deck. There's a lot of ways to go this. I think the more aggressive route is definitely better. You can put this in a secret tempo elemental deck or just a pure elemental tempo deck. There's a lot of different ways to go with this, but Steam Surger is solid. I think the payoff is so much weaker than something like Goblin Blast Mage, obviously. It doesn't immediately affect the board, and the stats are actually like pretty bad for a 4-drop. Like, you wouldn't play a 4-mana 5-4 just for the stats. So it's kind of like a value. It gets you value, but it loses you tempo, which I think is kind of counterintuitive to what elemental decks want to be doing on turn 4. You know, something like Water Elemental doesn't lose me tempo. I'm getting good stats for my 4-drop. This card's giving me bad stats, but it's giving me value. So it's a bit of a trade-off there. You know, I think on 6 mana, if you play this plus Flame Geyser all at once, that's pretty noticeably weaker than Fire Elemental in a couple ways. So overall, not the strongest card. I think the payoff should have been a little bit stronger. I think maybe if this had Chillwind Yeti stats, if they just flipped the health and attack on it, I think that would have been a very different story. But yeah, overall, like, you'll play it in an elemental mage deck, right? You're not going to play an elemental mage deck without this card. It is an elemental itself, which is nice, so you can keep the elemental train rolling. But overall, I'm not too impressed. I think the payoff's not quite as strong as it needs to be to make that kind of deck common. All right, next we got Primordial Glyph, which this card I'm so excited about. Oh my god, this card is nuts. I mean, you guys remember how excited I was about Unstable Portal back when it was released. I said it was the best card in that set. This is up there. Primordial Glyph is so stupid. Like, okay, how can I even compare this? It does so much, and there's so many different comparisons you can draw. So it's a very high power level card for a number of reasons. First of all, if there was a 0-mana card, if there was a 0-mana spell that said draw card, that would be busted. You would play 2 of it in every single deck because you effectively have a 28-card deck before you even take into account all the spell synergy you get from just playing a spell. So it's on that power level. It costs 2 mana up front, but you get that 2 mana back off of the cost reduction. The fact that it's replacing itself for a net cost of 0 mana is above the power curve for Hearthstone. It's at that power level of a 0 mana draw card. It's not quite that broken, but it's better in some ways sometimes. Second of all, you're discovering. You're not drawing a card from your deck. So sure, sometimes that's worse because you get 3 choices of garbage, but sometimes that's better. Mage puts itself in a lot of weird situations where there's different board states. You have a bunch of different spells in your class that all account for the board state differently. You know, a lot of times you just want AoE. A lot of times you just want a burn spell to go to the face. A lot of times you want like an ice block to stay alive for an extra turn. This card will win you games you have no business winning by giving you a card you should not have access to. It'll win you games by giving you AoE in a time where you shouldn't have it. It's impossible to play around for your opponent because these kinds of mechanics are stupid that way. You can just get like anything out of the entire range of mage spells. It's so powerful, and it's so unlikely that you get like a weak spell. Like, sure, sometimes you'll get 3 bad options and you'll get something mediocre, but even a mediocre option is not that bad. Like, there's no 3 unplayable mage spells. But sometimes it's just going to win you the game on its own. And most of the time, Most of the time, it's just giving you like a decent value, like a decent spell to replace itself at no cost to you. It'll trigger open the Waygate by giving you a spell that didn't start in your deck. And one of the very key things here is if you play it on curve, it works like Unstable Portal in letting you do stuff you should not be able to do ahead of time. So if I play this turn two, instead of hero powering face like you should, you should play it like early most of the time, unless you want to hold it for more information or whatever. You're basically like unstable portaling. You're banking an undercosted spell, and you're able to play Flame Strike on turn five, if that's what you're getting, like, or Blizzard on turn four. Like, things that your opponent really can't account for. They're not going to change their strategy based on the fact that you played Primordial Glyph turn two. So it just leads to these disgusting blowouts so often. You know, if you have Mana Worm in play, right, you're losing a game, your opponent's at 30 life, you manage to stick a Mana Worm, and they just play a bunch of stuff and let it live. You have lethal sometimes. All you need to do is Primordial Glyph into Primordial Glyph 30 times or 29 times, and you have lethal. Like, it's so busted. I don't know. That's like a really corner case example, but what I'm saying is you always have a chance as long as you have this card. So, yeah, just strong in all sorts of ways. I think, you know, unlike Unstable Portal, it's not giving you. It's not giving you a minion, obviously, but it's not giving you a cost reduction. You're not like netting mana by playing it the way you are with Unstable Portal, but you're getting a choice. And that choice more than makes up for the fact that you're not getting an extra mana of cost reduction. I would rather be able to choose my spell and get a cost reduction of two than choose my than just get a random spell and get a cost reduction of three, I think. Although I'd play both cards because they're both busted. Anyway, this is really strong. Look out for this card. All right, next we got Meteor, which is deal 15 damage and 3 to adjacent ones. I really like this card. Mage as it is, like you're not going to play this in a tempo deck or an aggro deck most of the time, so that pretty much just leaves control mage decks if they exist or combo mage decks like Freeze Mage. So Freeze Mage has so many tools now. You're going to be playing Arcanologist, you're going to be playing Primordial Glyph, you're going to be playing Medivh's Valet because you have Arcanologist, you have four secrets now. At the end of the day, you're playing a lot of stuff in your combo mage deck that doesn't leave much room for more effects like these. You're also having card draws, so you're going to get into your Blizzards and Frost Novas more often. So I'll say straight up, it's not as good as the freeze effects like Blizzard and Frost Nova. Freeze is just such a stupidly powerful thing to begin with. It's the closest thing we have to just time warp already to begin with, is to just freeze your opponent's board. This doesn't have like Doomsayer synergy as much, but it's still not unplayable. It's just tough to fit in a deck, but it is a good card. It's a strong card. It's a strong effect. I think if you're just playing like a one of to clear your opponent's board, you'd rather have it be Flame Strike because that's gonna make sure to kill everything. If it's just a one of, it's really you're aiming to play it after freezing your opponent's board for a while. But as far as just like an on curve kill stuff play, this is the best thing Mage has like in the game, right? If you're looking to kill some stuff on turn six defensively, this does it so well. If this card was around back in the days when we had Fatigue Mage, this would have been beyond broken. Like, this would have been easy two of in that deck, and that's a deck I'll try bringing back myself, actually, even without Deathlord being in the format. It'll probably be bad, but who knows. Point is, Meteor is, you know, the power level's there for it to see constructed play. There's not really space for it in the combo-oriented mage decks that we have today. I think if there are Kazakus mage decks, you will play this card for sure. It's great in decks like that, or any really control-oriented mage deck. But really, we'll see. You know, if this has a place long-term in mage, I think right now the Kazakus decks are the only ones that auto-include it. And finally, we've got Pyros, the other mage legendary. Pretty cool card. Yeah, you'll play this in the elemental mage decks. It's solid. I mean, it gives you a plan in the control matchups where you can just keep crapping out bigger guys. Overall, a 2-mana 2-2 is not bad nowadays as far as an on-curve play. There's no more busted Totem Golem Tunnel Trog crap going on. It's pretty much just Zoo that's playing strong early-game minions. But yeah, Pyros is powerful. It's a good card, and I think, you know, it's not like broken, it's just a role player card. It's really just going to come down to, does Elemental Mage see a lot of play, right? I'm not going to tell you to craft Pyros until we know how good Elemental Mage as a deck is. But if Elemental Mage is like a tier 2 deck, which is very possible, like Elemental Tempo Mage, this will be a part of it. If Elemental Mage just never sees play, then this card will never see play. You're not going to run it just on its own, just as a dude, just because you can. This really needs to be a part of a elemental strategy. Like, you need to care about the tribal tag to include it in your deck, I think. Maybe there's like some fatigue-based mage deck that this could be a part of, but even then, I think there's better fatigue-oriented cards to be running. That's about it for mage. I think I mostly covered it. We're going to move on to paladin next, and I've got to make an effort to be faster, because at this rate, it's going to be another 4-hour video. Alright, so paladin. First of all, Lost in the Jungle. Love this card. Living Roots has already shown that making 2/1/1s on turn 1 is solid stats. It can test the board. There's no more Tunnel Trog crap. It's really just Mana Worm that this interacts unfavorably with as far as other decks early game, or like the Rogue Hero power this is weak to. But other than that, it's a very strong card. It's going to get you on the board, get you doing work fast. Alley Cat, another card that, you know, shows that this does make the cut. You know, Alley Cat didn't see too much play just because we haven't, like, Hunter wasn't a class in the last expansion. But Lost in the Jungle, you know, is fine. There's a lot of ways you can play this. You can play it in a control paladin shell, even, as just like a way to get some early game. And then there's a Silverhand Recruit adapter that I'll talk about later in this review that, you know, can be used as a finisher. It's definitely no muster for battle. You're not going to play it like in that way, but just in any aggressive paladin deck, I think this will be an auto include. It costs a lot of mana to kill multiple one health minions with a hero power with something like Druid or Mage. So this is really good for a for a quest based paladin deck as well. Should have started by talking about the quest. I'll talk about that next. Lost in Jungle is a strong card. It'll see play in aggressive strategies for sure. It might see play in some niche control decks. It's just a high power level card. Alright, next I'm going to talk about the Paladin Quest, right? Cast 6 spells on your minions, reward Galvadon. This is like the second strongest reward out of any quest. Just like I said in my original review, it's very powerful as far as just the payoff, right? Because a 5-mana 5-5 that adapts 5 times, most of the time is equivalent to winning the game. Maybe like 75% of the time, this quest just wins you the game. Why? Well, you get stealth, your opponent can interact with it, the mechanic is very fun and interactive and well-designed. And then the other 4 buffs, you just spend buffing your guy. You're going to want to give him 3 attack, you're going to want to give him +1/+1. As I found out, a lot of times you don't want to give him the Fairy Dragon buff because then you can't buff him yourself, and you're probably going to want to do that in your buff deck because that's how you got him in the first place. Your opponent's just going to die. You give it Wind Fury, you give it Stealth, and then you kill them next turn. That's strong. Like, the payoff's good. Now, the quest condition is hard to meet, but the Pants Paladin deck, as I like to call it, has been around for a while, and, you know, it's something I've streamed, I think, more than anybody. I've been trying to make it work for a long time. I've been playing the whole Nat Pagel list for forever at this point. It's almost there, man. It just needs a few more tools, and then this quest is definitely possible to trigger reliably, but we'll see. You know, at the end of the day, all I can really do is judge how powerful cards are in a vacuum, because the metagame as a whole is really tough to define when you're doing a set review, even after having played with the cards for a couple days, because it's not just a matter of like how good is this individual card. Okay, which class has the most good cards between this set and the old sets? It's not really how metagame develops. It's more about what are the interactions like in the early game. That's usually what defines a metagame, right? Nothing beat Tunnel Trog, Totem Golem, Jade Claw openers. So Shaman is the best deck. There have been times when nothing could beat Wild Growth. That's when Druid was the best deck, right? That was just classic set. The things that are going to decide whether something like the Paladin Quest sees play is going to be how the metagame plays out at large. There's going to be interactions that matter, like, okay, well, Jade Claw kills Hydrologist, so the fact that, like, Jade Claw kills, like most two drops in the metagame have two health, so Jade Claw becomes a broken card, so okay, that means maybe Shaman's like one of the best classes again. Those are all things that are very possible, right? I can't begin to speculate whether this will be a tier one deck. All I can say is how strong the cards are in a vacuum. So Last Kaleidosaur wins the game, but has a tough condition to meet. We'll see how that plays out. All right, next we got Adaptation, which is a new one mana target spell. You're definitely going to be playing this in your quest deck. It's on the same power level as Blessing of Might. I would say this card's a little bit stronger, actually. Blessing of Might is something that's seen competitive play. So we've seen that in aggro decks. We've seen it in Pants Paladin, of course. And we'll see it in quest decks. I don't think we'll see it in anything outside of the quest-oriented decks, but in those, it'll definitely be strong enough. All right, next, we got Hydrologist, which is probably my favorite Paladin card in this expansion. It was before the review, and it was before I recorded the original review a few days ago, and it's still my favorite after having played with it a bit. Hydrologist is sick. I really like this card. Any Dark Peddler effect is just busted, and this card gets you, you could argue, a weaker Dark Peddler. You can't get a minion off of it, but Secrets are strong, too. At the end of the day, as a two-drop, the stats are fine. It's like it's got the Murloc tag, which is great because Murloc Paladin might be a thing. It has, the ability to be played as a three-drop with the secret that you get off of it. It's relevant in aggro matchups just by helping stabilize the board with like Noble Sacrifice. It's relevant in control matchups because you can get Getaway Kodo or Redemption for your Tyrians. Card's just good, you know. You pull it off Curator even, like. It does everything. Play it in your aggro decks, play it in your control decks. Card's sick. It's just Dark Peddler. Like, you just put it in stuff. Card's busted. All right, next we got Light-Fused Stegadon, which, just what Paladin needed, more 4-mana cards. This one has Battlecry Adapter Silverhand Recruits. So, this is much worse as a control finisher than Quartermaster was, but it can still be used as one. The fact that it's a beast matters because you can pull it off of Curator in a control-oriented Paladin deck, which, again, is the only type of deck I think this will see playing. I don't think you're going to run it in aggro or anything. You play it as a one-of or like a two-of in your control Paladin deck with a Curator. You pull it out. You buff your guys. Maybe you got some off of Lost in the Jungle. Maybe you got some off of Vine Cleaver, which is a weapon I'll talk about coming up. But in general, that's like the only real deck that this has a home in, right? You can use it as a quasi Quartermaster finisher in a Curator Paladin deck. On the bright side, I think most Paladin control decks will be Curator based. I think there's a really powerful dragon in the neutrals I'm going to talk about later. You can get Hydrologists out. This guy's a beast. You can play Kodo again if you want. I think it's possible to run it as a one of in those decks, and we'll see if that does end up being a thing. But outside of that, I'm not going to see too much play. Alright, so then we got Spike-Ridged Steed, a 6-mana, +2/+6, and taunt, and when it dies, you get a Stegadon. This is a card a lot of people in my chat keep talking up. I haven't personally put it in my deck. I think this card just sucks. I mean, in my opinion, I think it doesn't do nearly enough for 6-mana. I have to already have the board in order to be able to put it on something. I get +2/+6, which is, like, fine, but then it's, like, beyond vulnerable to silence, even if they don't silence it. As long as my opponent just has a big minion, I can just punch through it pretty easily. I think it's a pretty underwhelming card. I think it's a card that you have to already be winning the game in order for it to be good. But overall, it's not unplayable. I mean, there might be a world where you run it in mid-range strategy and it ends up being kind of solid. I don't know. I think there's better things to do with 6-mana personally, so I'm not very high on this card. Right. I don't think I would even play it in the quest deck because it's just too slow. I want to get my quest active by like turn 6 or 7 if I'm playing the quest deck. This has to be like literally the last buff I play for that to be the case. It's also expensive, so it makes Divine Favor worse, which is like also probably a card you want your quest deck built around. But yeah, point is not great. All right, next we got Vine Cleaver, which is a 7-mana 4/3. Whenever your hero attacks, summon 2/1/1 Silverhand Recruits. I love the flavor behind this card. I love that it tells a story. You know, you're cleaving the vines, you're freeing up Silverhand Recruits that got lost. It's cool. At the end of the day, I think this might be a one of in the Paladin control deck with the Light-Fused Stegadon that I just talked about as a finisher. But I don't think you're going to play it as more than that. You know, it might be like a Gorehowl type of effect. The same way Gorehowl's played in Control Warrior, that's how you play this in Control Paladin. But power level wise, it's just a little bit too weak. I think the card would be too strong if you change like any of the numbers on it, except maybe give it an extra attack or something. But Yeah, the card is fine. You know, it's not unplayable. It's not the absolute worst. It can do some powerful stuff. It's really something that's going to take a lot of tuning to decide if it does have a place in Control Paladin. You know, that's just something we'll figure out with time. But you know, I think it has potential. I do think it has potential. It's just not like you're not going to play it in aggro. You're not going to play it in mid range probably. It's just going to be like a one of in control if anything. And next, we got Primal Fin Champion, which is really the type of card that the Paladin Quest needed to help make the Pants Paladin a deck. The deck already had plenty of good buffs. What it didn't have was good things to put buffs on, right? When I was playing the deck, we were buffing Jinny of Zephyrs and the 4-mana dragon that got +1/+1 when it was targeted. Sorcerer or whatever. The point is, those cards were like fine, but you really needed like cheap things to buff. So things like the dragon egg that we used to have were really strong. And as that card rotated out, we get this guy now, which is clearly, you know, more built for this kind of quest strategy. The stats on him do suck. I don't think you're gonna run this guy in a like traditional Murloc deck or anything. I don't think you're gonna hybridize Murloc aggro with Quest Paladin or anything like that either. But it's in a dedicated Quest Paladin deck, it is something you're probably going to be running. I don't like how weak the stats are because you almost have to already have the board in order to play him. If you're playing him like on turn four and buffing him right away because the board's kind of even, that's also not a great situation because, I mean, at any point you lose the game to silence, obviously, but just beyond that, you are going to lose a lot of tempo. You spend a bunch of mana to make this guy that's understated and took a bunch of cards to do so. And when they kill him, you get those cards back and your quest is a little closer to being done, but you're losing tempo. And that's ultimately what's tough. Like, the only decks that have ever worked while losing tempo in Hearthstone are like Control Warrior and like combo decks like Handlock could have been argued to be a combo deck back in the day, or like Freeze Mage, you know. These are the only decks that are like okay giving up the board. I don't know if the last Kaleidosaur Paladin deck is really a true combo deck in that sense. So it makes me skeptical that that deck will see play when cards like this make it feel like you're going to be behind on board most of the time. So yeah. All right, next we got Dino-Size, which is an 8-mana spell, set of minions attack and health 10. So back in the day in beta, Pyroblast only cost 8 mana. The card was busted. You couldn't interact with it with taunts. There wasn't that much healing. The metagame revolved around it. It wasn't as broken as Blood Imp, but it was the second best card in the game. But despite that, here we have Dino-Size, which also has the potential to deal 10, kill your opponent out of nowhere for just 8 mana. But this card's a lot easier to interact with, right? You get to interact with taunt minions. There's a lot more healing in the game now. The jury's still out on if, you know, this type of card can see play, but man, bopping somebody for 10 right away is, that's no joke. The thing with this card, unlike Pyroblast, is it leaves your big idiot on the table. Your dino is still doing dino stuff. Like, you're still in a position where your opponent has to deal with the threat, and they've already taken 10. Like, that is a pretty powerful effect, and I think if anything can make a mid-range Paladin deck viable, I think this is it. And yeah, I think Dino-Size just has a lot of potential moving forward. But on the other hand, right, like, the card is just a really big buff, and the reality is, even though I think this is more competitively viable than Spike Ridged Steed, it's possible that this just never sees play, and we never really have a place for it, right? In a vacuum, though, the card is playable. It's a lot of people would see an 8-mana buff as like a win more card, but a card isn't really win more if it can just win outright in some cases, right? Like, if having the board by a little bit, like having a Silverhand Recruit up against a board of nothing, if that enables me to play a card like Dino-Size and just kill my opponent and win the game single-handedly, that's not a win more card in that case. That's just pretty different than playing a Spike Ridged Steed if I'm ending the game immediately. So that's why I'm rating these cards differently. I think Dino-Size has potential, but we'll see how the metagame shakes out, see if it has a place. I think at the end of the day, it's not going to be in hyper aggro. It's not going to be in control. It's going to be in like a mid-range Paladin deck if that ends up being a strategy that works. All right, then we got Sunkeeper Tarim, finally, the second legendary of the expansion. this card's really powerful, right? I'm not gonna say it's completely broken, but it's like it's strong, and I'll definitely start by including it in just every Paladin deck, more or less, everything except for the Quest Paladin, just to see how it plays out. I mean, it's obviously a very strong card. If you have a lot of your own tokens in play, it's going to do crazy stuff for you. If your opponent has just a couple minions you have a hard time dealing with, this is going to enable you to interact with those. You know, this does kill your opponent the way that Quartermaster kills your opponent, but it also just has stats that line up really well when you just play it on most boards. If you're losing to a swarm of minions out of zoo or something, and you're actually upgrading them by giving them 3 attack and 3 health, then it's not going to be that strong. But if your opponent is playing just like a couple medium-sized dudes at a time, this is going to do a lot for you. If something like Jade Druid ends up being prevalent in the metagame, this also gives you a strategy there where, you know, it just buys you some time before you kill them with another you know, something else that you have going on. Sunkeeper is solid. It's just a good role player card. I think you're going to run it in your control decks. I think you're going to run it in your mid-range decks. And I do think it has potential. Definitely a solid card. You know, if you're a really big fan of Paladin, wait a week to make sure the Paladin has some viable strategy. But if it does, I think Sunkeeper Tarn will be a part of it and will be worth crafting. All right. Next, we got Priest, which is a pretty interesting class to reveal this expansion. I'm going to start with the quest so we can get this garbage out of the way. Play 7 Deathrattle minions. Reward, Amara, Warden of Hope. Yeah. I'm not a big fan of... Okay. I should say this about quests in general. I don't like that they discourage creative deck building, which they do. When I put Awaken the Makers in my deck, my list is going to have like 20 cards identical to everyone else's Awaken the Makers deck, just right off the bat. And on one hand, that's a good entry point for casual players because they feel like they're deck building and like, oh, let me share this with friends and look at this totally original Awaken the Makers deck I built. And it'll be like the same as like a pros list, except it'll have like a Fen Creeper and an Ancient of Blossoms in it or something ridiculous. I think that these decks definitely have a place and I think they're good for the game, but I think that they should be limited to just one or two strategies the way that, like, you know, put Jade Druid into an expansion, but then like, leave the other decks up in the air. Whereas like all the quest decks kind of build themselves more or less. Not all of them, but you know, this one does. Anyway, that aside, from the deck building perspective, I think that this is a little bit too weak of a card. And this is why, right? You have to think about the payoff. So Amara, Warden of Hope, just as a card itself, it looks so broken, it looks so good, but it's a card that's fundamentally only good against aggro. If you're in a control matchup, an 8-8 is not going to kill your opponent. It's not a win condition. Setting your health to 40 doesn't matter at all. It's like nothing this card does matters against combo or control decks. It only matters against aggro. So that means your quest reward only matters against aggro. But then in order to get your quest reward off, you have to keep a quest in your opening hand against aggro, which means you're down a card. You're that much less likely to have another removal spell, another 2-mana card like Doomsayer or whatever your spell reducer guy or just whatever you're playing. You're reducing the likelihood that you can keep up with your aggro opponent by keeping your secret in the first place. And when you think about how often it was that, you know, people got killed before they could play their Reno, think about this card. Like, okay, sure, the aggro decks are way worse now, and let's say the average game takes 2 turns longer. Awaken the Makers is still coming out so late. I mean, 7 Deathrattle minions is tough to do. That's a super late game Amara that you're getting, and that, at the end of the day, is the biggest problem with this card. It's an effect, like, the payoff. Amara is only good against aggro, but the quest takes too long to trigger against aggro. So if you do trigger the quest, it's at a point where the game's already been decided. And I think that ultimately is what's going to keep this from seeing play. I think if the quest wasn't Deathrattle related, basically like the quest condition has to be completely different for Amara, Warden of Hope, to be a decent payoff. If they want this quest condition, we're playing 7 Deathrattle minions, and they want it to see play, I think Amara has to do something that's relevant against control. Which it doesn't. So there's a mismatch between what the quest wants you to do and what the payoff is. And that's why I think it's a pretty weak quest overall. All right, moving on, we got Binding Heal, first of all. So it's, you know, you got to compare it to Flash Heal, which we used to have. This one's a lot more awkward with the cards like Akanai and Embrace the Shadows and all that, but aside from that little issue, it's definitely stronger just in a vacuum. Like when I just want to use it to heal my you know, injured Blade Master, you know, you are getting double value more or less. That's pretty cool. Is it good enough to see play? I think probably not. I think injured Blade Master is finally just beaten out by better minions for the most part. But it's a card that can see some amount of play, you know, in the right Priest deck. I think even with Lyra, there's better one mana things to be playing. There is definitely some value in playing certain one-ofs of Priest spells because of Shadow Visions, which is a new Priest spell I'll talk about in a bit. But yeah, for the most part, it'll be like a niche card. I don't expect this to see too much play. All right, next we got Radiant Elemental. So Hell froze over, it turns out, and Blizzard printed a Priest minion with a casting cost of 2. Really shocked here. It is an elemental that might matter for Priest moving forward. The stats are fine. A 2-mana 2-3 is actually like the biggest 2-drop you can get now. So it actually stacks up pretty well against other 2-drops. You don't need insane things like 2-mana 2-4s anymore. And that's a solid card, you know. The spell reduction has a lot of synergy with the Priest Legendary. Radiant Elemental gives you some nut draws just on its own. Like, if you get a Power Word Shield in your opening hand, this is so broken. Like, to play a 2-mana 2-5 in a class that has the Priest Hero Power is so sick. You're going to snowball the board against, like, anything from that point. And then you Talon Priest the turn after. It can just get really gross. You can play Pint-Sized Potion the turn you play this guy. There's a lot of cool stuff you can do with him, basically. It's a powerful card. Good 2-drop. It'll see a lot of play. Elemental decks, whatever. Just about any Priest deck, I think, we'll be playing this guy. All right, next we got Tortle and Shellraiser, which is, you know, the good taunt minion that Priest really needed if it was going to make an Awaken the Makers or a Nazoth deck. I mean, at this point, I'm wondering, if I build a Nazoth Priest deck, do I even play the quest? Like, maybe not. Maybe I don't. Tortle and Shellraiser, though, is a great minion. Like, this is a card where the Death Rattle is kind of similar to Dark Cultist, but this one is a lot more likely to give you value because, okay, when your opponent played Dark Cultist, which for those guys who don't know, there's like a 3-mana 3-4, Death Rattle give a friendly minion 3 health. That card people would play around by killing your other stuff first, and then they would kill your Death Rattle guy last, so you just wouldn't get the buff. But they don't have the luxury of doing that through Tortle and Shellraiser because he has Taunt. He kind of demands that he dies first, at least with minion damage. So you're getting the extra 1-1 stats out of this guy most of the time. You're getting a 3-7 worth of stats overall. You're getting taunt. Most importantly, you're getting a good taunt body off of a Nazoth, which that's really important because with Nazoth, the issue with that card for a long time was that, okay, well, I play my Nazoth and they just kill me, which is why people were playing like Infested Tauren and other really bad cards just to have a taunt off of him. Tortle and Shellraiser is actually good as a 4-drop. So whether it sees play in non-Nazoth decks is kind of up in the air. I think Priest of the Feast is kind of a better 4-drop in general in those decks. But, you know, we'll see moving forward whether, you know, it fits in. All right, next we got Crystalline Oracle. This is a card I tweeted about. I was pretty upset about this kind of a mechanic. Like, I don't like... I think Hearthstone, you know, has an issue with a lack of counterplay. I made a video about counterplay. I recommend you guys watch that if you haven't. It's here on this channel. Just, like, search Raynad counterplay. These kinds of effects limit it, right? Because when you play against an opponent that played a Crystalline Oracle, and they got a random card out of your deck... For the most part, like, you can't account for all the things they got. Like, in some cases you can. You're like, okay, the only AoE in my deck is this card, and AoE in this particular situation is the only thing I lose to, so I'll play around it. But, like, 90% of the time, you can't play around the card they got off of this. So when they play the card that they got, and they blow you out with it, you're just going to feel really bad. And when they get a card that's completely useless, they're going to feel really bad. So it's just the kind of effect that not only does it not encourage any counterplay because you're just going to play your hand out as if the Death Rattle never happened because you can't account for all the outcomes. It doesn't promote counterplay, but it also makes one player pissed off most of the time it's played. I think like this kind of mechanic is okay to put in the game if they just revealed the card that was taken. I think that's something they should do for Swashburglar. I think it's something they should do for this card. I think it's something they should do for Draconid Operative. So anyway, that's kind of my feeling on the mechanic overall. As a card though, this is strong enough to see play. It's Web Spinner power level, but better because you're getting like a constructed card. You're not getting garbage most of the time. And beyond that, it's an elemental, which might actually matter for Priest, right? Elementals have a pretty powerful neutral shell that you can build around. Definitely give you a lot of options. So yeah, solid card. It will see play. And yeah, there's a chance that the popular Priest deck doesn't want to run a Web Spinner type of effect, but you know, it's the power level's there. In a vacuum, this card's good enough. All right, next we got Mirage Caller. Battlecry, choose a friendly minion, summon a 1/1 copy of it. This card's obviously at its strongest with good Death Rattle minions. You can do some crazy stuff with Cairn and stuff like that. It's a powerful card. We haven't really had a cheap effect like this before, and it enables definitely some interesting synergies moving forward. I expect Mirage Caller to see some play, you know, if some version of N'Zoth Priest does take off. But just as an on-curve minion, it's not going to see play in every Priest deck. You really need to be kind of Death Rattle centric for this to see play. In an effort to speed up, I'm going to go over to Free from Amber, which is a new Priest spell, 8 mana. Discover a minion that costs 8 or more, summon it. I think overall, if I'm going to play an expensive idiot in my deck, I want it to be the idiot of my choice. I'd rather pay one extra mana and have Ysera all the time that wins me the game. I'd rather, pay two extra mana and play N'Zoth that wins me the game. And get the Battlecry out of it. I think that Free from Amber, you know, has some cool synergies with like the Charge Dragon and the neutral part of this set, but in general, power level's not quite there. I think the card's not good enough for Constructed. There is one thing you can do with it. You can play a one of to play it with Shadow Visions, the card I'm about to talk about. It's part of like a toolbox, it's like a late game thing to discover, but outside of that, I don't expect this to see too much play, aside from occasionally being a random one of in control. I don't think it's that strong. All right, next we got Shadow Visions. This is a really interesting card, right? 2 mana spell, discover a copy of a spell in your deck. This lets you do some crazy stuff. Like, okay, on a surface level, this card is like way worse than Primordial Glyph, right? Obviously it is. Primordial Glyph is busted. But Shadow Visions is a pretty strong card in and of itself. The fact that you can cost reduce this with like Radiant Elemental and get a choice of good spells that you intentionally put in your deck lets you kind of create this toolbox where maybe you play like 4 Dragonfire Potions in a game, or maybe you play like 3 Shadow Ward Deaths and I don't know, like Free from Amber to win the game. It lets you do a lot of crazy stuff, and I think this kind of card will be a core part of a lot of Priest decks. It's not hard to find a turn where you have 2 mana available, and to be able to discover from 3 powerful options that you intentionally put in your deck is really strong. And I think the synergy with the Priest 2-drop in this expansion and the legendary that I'm about to talk about both push this card over the top to the point where I think it will see a decent amount of play. Right, next we got Curious Glimmer Root, which is a really interesting card. A lot of people point to this card as an example of being a skill testing card. And I think that like below rank 15, that's true. I think it will, separate the good rank 15 players from the bad rank 20 players. At legend rank, it's not really skill testing. It's just kind of tilting 5% of the time the way the Barnes is. Overall, I like the mechanic. I think it's cool. It's new. I'm glad they're doing it. I think the stats are interesting. It's basically a 3-mana 3/3 that draws you a card most of the time. We haven't had access to an effect like this before. I think the card might just be really strong. Time will tell. Worse than Talon Priest, but you know, still like really, this card's really interesting to me. Really interesting to me. But with that said, from a design standpoint, right, to a player that has a decent grasp of the metagame, just like, you know, let's say the expansion's been out for a couple months. Most people know what most people are playing. At most ranks, somebody plays Curious Glimmer Root. Like, it's going to draw you a card most of the time, but let's say you're playing against, like, Pirate Warrior, and you look at their deck, and you see like crappy, you see like Stolen Goods, Dread Corsair, South Sea Captain, right? Because not every pirate deck plays South Sea Captain, believe it or not, and not every deck plays Dread Corsair. It's like, at that point, there's two options where, okay, these kind of make sense. My opponent could be playing both of them. It's kind of like literally a coin flip. Yeah, like you have nothing to point towards either of those options being more likely. Like something like 5% of the time or 1% of the time, you're gonna get screwed out of your extra card, and that's gonna be kind of annoying. But that aside, overall, I like the mechanic. No card can be absolutely perfect. I think I would rather have this card be in the game than not. And I like that Blizzard is experimenting with more like skill testing mechanics. So yeah, I'm a fan of this card. I like it. I think power level wise, it might actually see play just because we haven't seen like a 3-mana 3/3 draw card before. This is worse than drawing a card because it's not giving you a card out of your deck, but it's still a constructed power level card that you're getting, and that makes it pretty interesting to me. All right, finally we got Lyra the Sun Shard, the last legendary for Priest in this expansion, the second legendary. Lyra the Sun Shard is a card that a lot of people were shit talking on Reddit when it got revealed for like just a lot. I didn't really understand why. I mean, Gadgets and Auctioneer was so good that it had to get nerfed, and this card has better stats than Gadgets and Auctioneer. It's an elemental, which might matter in some decks. This class has Sorcerer's Apprentice in it, and it gets you priest spells, so it chains into itself without you even needing spells in your deck. This card seems pretty powerful to me, and it seems like it could take a game over on its own in a lot of cases. There's synergy with Shadow Visions. Obviously a lot of the priest spells that you get suck, but like if they suck and they still cycle themselves, it's fine. Like, this card seems like decent to me, and it just seems like a solid plan B for winning a game. I don't think you can build a deck to just like only bank on Lyra the Sun Shard winning you the game and then like playing a Leeroy the way that Miracle Rogue does. I don't think it'll work like that, but it's just like you're gonna be playing a bunch of spells anyway. Probably gonna be playing like a Shadow Visions package anyway. Like, this card just, in my last review, I said I think this card's pretty okay, and right now I'll say I think this card's pretty okay. It just seems solid to me. If you're playing Priest, I mean, I have a hard time picturing a Priest deck without this card in a lot of cases. I'm pretty sure you should run it most of the time, at least in any like Shadow Visions based deck. So yeah, surprise, this doesn't see more play. I think it's sweet. It's just a solid card. It might be the case that it's just a little bit too weak to run, but I think it's good. Moving on, we got Rogue. This is the class. Okay, dude, this class made me so pissed that I missed my trip, or that I was on a trip and I missed the first 2 days of the expansion. Because I was telling my stream, right? I was streaming before I left for Israel. Everyone was asking me, "Okay, Reynad, what's the first Un'Goro deck you want to try? What are you excited about?" I talked about it on Valuetown. I'm like, "I'm excited for Caverns Below. I don't know how to evaluate that deck. I think it could be broken. I think it could be terrible. I think it could be really fun to play. I'm excited for Rogue the most because I think it'll be like a new archetype. It'll be fun." And I was hyping up this deck. I was so excited to play it. And then I get back, like, an expansion's been out for 2 days. All of Reddit's like calling for nerfs to Cavern of Souls. Dog's gotten, or not just Dog, like a bunch of streamers have like played it first already. And I was just salty, man. This was the first deck I was gonna craft. I was so excited to play it. But whatever. I'll start with the quest and review the class. Now I haven't, by the way, I haven't played a game of this of the Rogue Quest deck just because it's mainstream and people are complaining about it. I don't think it's as good as people are claiming it is. Like, it's good, but it's not like beyond busted or anything, I don't think yet. I don't know. Our point is, Caverns Below, right? 1 mana quest, play 4 minions of the same name, reward Crystal Core. For the rest of the game, your minions are 5/5. So, a lot of you guys will think I'm cheating or whatever, and they want to shit talk set reviewers. Whatever. A lot of people want to look back at a review, listen to a streamer say this card's unplayable, and then claim that, he was so wrong, blah, blah, blah. I think I actually reviewed this card on Valuetown. I want to like go back and see what I said on the last episode of Valuetown. That was kind of my initial impression of the card, but I think it was before we had all the cards revealed. Point is, caverns below, right? I'll give you my impression of the card now, which is not that different from my impression a week ago. I think this card is really strong. Obviously, it has a lot of potential. I think this has the single best payoff of any quest card. So, as in the card you're getting that re as your reward, just wins you the game, like almost always. That's pretty damn sick. Like, that's a really, really. When the payoff is that good for something in any card game, it's generally going to dictate that an archetype is built around it. So the condition for this quest, play four minions of the same name, is pretty easy to do, actually. I mean, it's not necessarily consistent or reliable. It's fairly reliable, but the thing is, it's fast. So this is one of the few quests that you can play on curve. Like, you'll play your 5-mana reward on turn 5 or earlier if you have preparation. This is just like, it's definitely a deck that kind of builds itself, right? You play your cheap battle cries, you play Mimic Pod, you play prep. Like, it's not going to look too different based on who's built it. But with that said, it's a deck that it's going to require some amount of skill to play. If you misplay, you'll generally lose with this deck. It still has weaknesses. It's weak to aggro. I think the Caverns Below is just a really interesting, like, new way to play the game, and I think that I'm happy to see a rogue archetype that isn't just Miracle Rogue seeing play. So I think it's interesting. I don't know. I look forward to playing with it some more on my next stream, probably later today. And yeah, I like the card. I again, maybe is it too good? A lot of people are saying it's like completely broken. I don't think so. My win percentage against the deck has been like pretty good, and I've been playing mostly garbage. I think it's just like Miracle Rogue. It's going to prey on control decks, and it's going to struggle against like really aggressive decks or just go face. But it's definitely a high power level deck. Definitely really strong. Has game against everything more or less. And if anything, I've been more annoyed by Glacial Shard than I've been annoyed by this quest. The stupid freeze battlecry guy is just so annoying. But yeah, other than that, I don't know. I think the quest has potential, and I mean, obviously the quest has potential. Obviously the quest is good. I don't think it's completely busted yet. I don't know if it needs a nerf. That's going to take some time to find out. But it's definitely a good deck. I'm glad it's a good deck. I think it's a different play style, and I like seeing those in the game. All right, moving on. We got Hallucination, first rogue spell. This card is nuts, man. Like, just okay. If rogue had a 1-mana spell that just said draw card, rogue would play two of it. Every list would play two of it. Back in the mid-range hunter days in beta, back when flare cost 1 mana, it was actually one of the things I got known for. It was playing two flares in all my lists, period, every time. I would call the deck Cycle Hunter back then, and then when the mid-range hunter deck that Life Coach made got popular, I put two flares in that deck too, and I never cut them till they got nerfed. 1 mana, what I'm saying is basically 1 mana draw card is broken. It's good enough for almost every deck because you're essentially playing a 28 card deck when you do that. Now, Hallucination doesn't draw you a card from your deck, right? You're drawing a card from your opponent's class, but again, you're discovering. And when you discover that's so busted, it's like a reverse Primordial Glyph, which we've already determined is busted. This one doesn't give you the cost reduction or like let you bank it and then play it for free later, but it's a 1-mana spell, man. It's a 1-mana spell in Rogue. Like, you always have an extra turn to do these kinds of things. The fact that you're not playing anything else turn one means you just run it out turn one. You can run it out later, draw cards off gadgets in, trigger your Sharazin, which, you know, the new legendary. There's just so many synergies with this. It lets you do things you're not supposed to be able to do. If you're against Aggro Shaman and you're discovering like among five different healing cards, right? I mean, you can get like Halazeal healing. Is Healing Wave in the game anymore? I don't even know or care. You can get like the elemental guy that heals you if you have elementals in your deck. You can get like the, well, yeah, the 3-mana elemental and then the 8-mana elemental, the primal guy. Point is, like, it lets you do things your class isn't supposed to be able to do. It's going to tilt your opponent off the face of the earth, playing against the range of 35 cards in their own class that can blow them out. And yeah, it's a powerful card. 1 mana, it replaces itself. This card's sick. And next, you got Razor Petal Volley. Add two Razor Petals to your hand, deal one damage. I think this card's just too underpowered. I think it really should have given you three Razor Petals, or it should have cost one mana. I don't know. Maybe it would be too good in both of those cases, but I think this card's really underwhelming. At two mana to play and then two petals to hand, that's just a really low payoff for really high investment. Like, two petals is probably worth one card to this deck, and you're paying like two mana to pseudo cycle, but then you have to pay two mana again to actually get your payoff for that. Like, to pay four mana to deal two damage overall, as much synergy as this has, it's just not, it's not nearly good enough, right? It's just too expensive. It does too little. I'm really not optimistic about this card. Next, we got Razor Petal Lasher, which is a 2-mana 2-2 that adds one Razor Petal to your hand. So for the same mana cost, you're getting a 0-mana 2-2 and one less Razor Petal. That's just so good. This card's actually solid. 2-mana 2-2, like we've established, is actually like on par for 2-drops now, so it'll trade with most other 2-drops, especially when you consider your hero power being active most of the time as Rogue. But then the, you know, the one damage, the one Razor Petal is pretty valuable too, right? It's going to trigger your combos, it's going to trigger Sharazin, it's going to work with Auctioneer. Just a solid 2-drop card. I expect this to maybe find a place in Miracle Rogue, maybe even in Tempo Rogue. It's a fine card that, you know, we'll see play. And next we got Mimic Bod. This is a card that really is mostly for the Caverns Below deck, right? You're going to play two of it. Get your duplicates, going to help trigger your cavern on turn four, ideally. It's a strong card. You can preparation it out. On paper, you're getting the same amount of value as Arcane Intellect, and even though, if Arcane Intellect was a card for Rogue, every Rogue deck would play two of it. But Arcane Intellect draws you into specific cards. It's going to draw you into deeper towards your preparation. It's going to draw you deeper towards Auctioneer, specific cards you're looking for. Mimic Pod isn't as good as drawing... It's not as good at drawing you towards specific things in your deck, but it does have random blowout potential with things you shouldn't be able to do. So when you get like double Edwin off of it, or when you, I don't know, get double Eviscerate or double Leroy, or like when you get even double Counterfeit Coin or double Prep sometimes, just lets you do things that your opponent can't really account for that you shouldn't have been able to do. And that random blowout potential kind of is a trade-off for being worse at finding specific cards for combo decks. Mimic Pod, I think, is a really strong card, and this will see a lot of play. You know, I think it might even see play outside of the Caverns Below decks, just because it's so close to an Arcane Intellect effect. That alone might be good enough to see play. But yeah, very solid card. All right, next we got Envenom Weapon. Give your weapon poisonous. I think this card's pretty bad. You know, in theory, You're putting it on your hero power weapon most of the time, so you're getting two attacks. In order to really take advantage of poisonous, you need to be killing really big minions. But then if you're killing really big minions with your face, you're going to die, because Rogue doesn't heal. It's one of its biggest weaknesses. Like, you don't want to be meleeing your opponent's 4-mana 7-7. So in Venom Weapon, I think, you know, the poisonous doesn't matter as much when you're killing mid-sized minions. And most mid-sized minions die to a different weapon buff, Deadly Poison. So compared to Deadly Poison, it's just so much worse. You're paying three times the mana to be able to kill minions you don't want to be attacking anyway. I think the life loss is just too big to make this card really that strong. So overall, underwhelmed. Don't expect it to see much play. Next, we got Obsidian Shard, which says cards cost one less for each card you played from another class. This can be a really cost-effective Assassin's Blade type of finisher for a tempo Ethereal Peddler deck. I think we have a lot of tools now with Hallucination that give us random cards in the opponent's deck. And it's not just putting Hallucination in a Miracle Rogue deck that might be a thing. Now you can actually play Tempo Rogue and play Ethereal Peddler, which is a really strong 5-drop. There's no more Azure Drake. It's a really strong 5-drop. That could just be like the new version of Tempo Rogue, right? You're stealing a bunch of stuff from your opponent's deck, just like every other class, because Swashburglar's broken and a mistake. And you're playing your Hallucination, you're playing your Ethereal Peddler, whatever, Shaku. And then Obsidian Shard is just this random Assassin's Blade finisher that just lets you put your opponent in Leroy range in the mid-game. So basically, it's not a card that's going to be played in any Rogue deck aside from that very niche one, and that very niche one might not even be a real deck. You know, it might just be strictly worse than Miracle, it might never see play. It's probably worse than the Caverns Below deck. But it's worth thinking about, right? It's not completely unplayable. It does have a home in that strategy, potentially. Next, we got Biteweed, which gains 1-1 for each other card you played this turn. I really don't like this card. I think it's pretty bad. I mean, you need to play three cards before it in order for it to be decent. Like, a 2-mana 3-3 that you need to play two cards before, I think is pretty underwhelming. Maybe I'm wrong about this card, but in order to put it in a deck, you'd probably be playing multiples of it, right? You'd probably be playing, like, two of them. And you'd have to, like, fit it in a turn where you're just, like, really going off with a bunch of spells. You can really only go all in a couple times. You know, if you go all in with Edwin, you can't also go all in with Biteweed. So that's awkward. If you go all in to revive your Sharazen, the legendary we'll talk about in a bit, you also don't really have stuff left for Biteweed and vice versa. So I think there isn't really a home for this card. I think the power level is just a little bit too weak, but I think maybe in Wild, or maybe if they introduce more cards that replace themselves like Hallucination, this can end up seeing a good amount of play. But right now it's just not quite there. Maybe if Razor Petal Volley was stronger, it could see play, but yeah, I think it's just a little bit too weak overall, but it's an interesting effect. I like that they made another Edwin, I'd say. All right, next we got Vilespine Slayer. So in my original review I did a couple days ago, I said this card is completely unplayable. You should never run it ever. The card just completely sucks. What do you want to assassinate anyway? Just play Sap. Like, Spider Tank isn't that good. This is a card where my opinion has definitely changed after having played with the expansion for a couple days. I think now, having seen it be played more, it makes more sense to me. I was thinking that, you know, in the mid game, there aren't any big minions that you want to kill anyway, but it turned out that's not really the case. There's a lot of decent sized dudes that come out before turn five that just being able to counterfeit coin into this guy, or, you know, coin Vilespine Slayer, becomes a pretty powerful play. And Assassinate, you know, even though Assassinate's not a good enough card for standard, Vilespine Slayer is enough better that it's definitely a card stronger than I thought. One key thing that made Vilespine Slayer more playable, I think, is the fact that Hallucination is now in the format. The fact that you have this like one mana spell that you can just throw out that replaces itself whenever really lets you enable this guy in turn six pretty consistently as well. So you don't always need the coin or the counterfeit coin to make him happen. So, you know, Vilespine Slayer, pretty solid card. I mean, in pure Miracle Rogue, I think I'd still prefer Saps, but he's solid, and I think if you're playing more of like a dude-oriented strategy, he's a card you want to be playing. Next, we got Sharazen, the final Rogue card, the second Rogue Legendary. This is another card that I've done a 180 on after having seen it play out. So in my original review that got corrupted, I said this card completely sucks. I really don't like it. The condition's too slow. It's like the world's worst piloted shredder. There's better 4-drop options with Barnes and stuff. The reality is, with Tomb Pillager rotating out, there's definitely a hole in the 4-drop spot with Rogue. And this gives you kind of a version of inevitability that makes your mid to late game pretty strong against most decks. I'm still not sold on this guy, man. I still think Violet Teacher might just be better, but he's not unplayable, right? Like, I'm not going to say he's incredible and he should be an auto include in every Rogue deck. I still think Violet Teacher might just be better, but he's okay, and he might just be a role player card that you should include anyway. There's still cards like Zeril to consider too that have a lot of value, so I'm on the fence on this guy. He's playable. I don't think he's broken, but the question is he better than the other 4-drops? I think in a control-heavy metagame, he's very good. In the more aggressive metagames, you'd want the other 4-drops instead. Let's go into Shaman. All right, so Shaman, first of all. All right, Shaman, so Air Elemental. 1-mana, 2-1, can't be targeted. This card sucks. Don't play it. Don't think about playing it. Let it go. Moving on, we got Hot Spring Guardian. Blizzard really made a push to make Shaman a pure control deck. Lots of good healing, lots of good AoE, lots of good removal, lots of good finishers. No good early game. Hot Spring Guardian, yeah, this card's gonna... You know, just one of the reasons that if Pirate Warrior gets too popular, you can just easily tech against it to blow it out. This card's stronger than Earthen Ring Farseer. It's just got the elemental synergy and everything. It's a very anti-aggro card. Yeah, it's a solid man. Definitely a minion worth running in an elemental oriented shaman deck. The thing about the elemental shaman deck overall is it's very It's very like much like a traditional control deck. So you're just killing stuff, gaining life. You're not doing too much proactive stuff. You're playing like mediocre statted elementals here and there. And overall, that kind of deck is really vulnerable to combo-oriented, rogue decks or combo-oriented like Freeze Mage decks like that potentially. So Freeze Mage, again, you might be able to beat just because you have so much healing. But, you know, in a nutshell, the Shaman deck's just weak to combo, and it's not possible to build like a mid-range Shaman or an aggro Shaman that just beats every single deck the way that, you know, the old Shaman decks did. So Hot Spring Guardian, good in elemental Shaman, good role player card. All right, Tidal Surge, deal 4 damage, gain 4 life. What a sick anti-aggro card. I mean, this is the kind of card that you definitely don't want to be running in a control or a combo heavy metagame, but this obliterates aggro. I mean, to deal 4 damage and gain so much life is just something that a deck like Pirate Warrior or like Face Hunter just can't really recover from. With that said, though, power level-wise, it's definitely on the weaker end. I think for most Shaman decks, it's not going to see play. It's kind of just like a different type of healing wave effect. This one gets you some board control, a lot less life, but you're also not going to want to put it in your deck unless, you know, you really want like that big healing effect. You'd rather have like a Jinyu Water Speaker before this card, for example, I think most of the time. All right, next we got Fireplume Harbinger, battle card, used to cost your elementals in your hand by 1. I mean, yeah, Totem Golem was so oppressive for so long that this is how Blizzard's now overcompensating. They're giving us 2-mana 1/1. I don't like this card. I think it's definitely on the underwhelming end. I think for it to be strong, you need to have a hand that's mostly full of elementals, and those aren't really hands that you want to be, keeping. I think when you compare this card to MechWarper back in the day, you can see how big of a mistake MechWarper was. Yeah, this card is just too underpowered, I think, stats-wise. I think it's like getting a really delayed, crappy Innervate, and that's just not what you want out of your cards in this game. It does have the Elemental tag on its own, so it's going to be enabling the Elemental guys for next turn, but there isn't really like a 4-drop Elemental that really wants an Elemental to have been played before him. It doesn't curve that well into anything reliably. All right, next we got Primal Fin Totem. It's a pretty cool new Shaman card. So Primal Fin Totem is one of the few reasonable turn 2 plays in Shaman. Now, when it's not preceded by Tunnel Trog, it's really easy for this card to get run over by any aggressive deck. But it does consistently output value in the mid-range or aggressive matchups. Still vulnerable to Fiery War Axe, of course. This card is... Oh, I should have really started with the Shaman Quest. It's just so bad I didn't want to get into it. But all right. Primal Fin Totem as a card is... You know, it's something you'll probably include in your aggressive Shaman lists, but there's multiple different archetypes for Shaman that you can build. All of them kind of work around a tribe. So Elemental Shaman, you're not going to want to run this in. It has no synergy for that. The stats aren't good enough to just stick on the board on its own the way Totem Golem was. So it's not a card you're going to want to include in the Elemental-oriented decks. You're not going to want to include it in Control because you don't want an effect like this. What do you include it in? Well, it's two archetypes. You can play it in the pure Murloc deck. Instead of, you know, some of the more aggressive Murlocs, you can play this, have a more constant stream. Maybe that deck's better at getting early game board control, and then, you know, you'll want this kind of effect. You can run it in those decks for sure. Or you can run it in the a deck that people haven't really been playing much yet in the metagame, which is Totem Shaman, right? We still have Witch Doctor. We still have Primal Fusion. We still have Bloodlust, things like that. And this kind of card, you know, thing from below, in this kind of card in the more Totem-oriented Shaman deck is actually one of the better turn two plays you can have, because without Totem Golem, there's just not a whole lot going on in the early game that you can be doing, unless you want to be playing like Doomsayer in your mid-range deck, and that just gets kind of awkward, right? So yeah, overall Primal Fin's a solid card. I think in those two archetypes you can run it. It's not going to define the deck or create new archetypes on its own, but it's just like a role player card in those strategies if you want it. All right, next we got Volcano. This is a card I wish we had in the game earlier, because now that we have it, there's no real good place for it. I think in a world with Elemental Destructions and Lightning Storms. This card would have seen a lot of play too in those really slow control-y Shaman decks. Right now, the control Shaman decks look like Elementals for the most part, and the Elemental Shaman decks just want to be curving out. They don't really want to overload. They're going to have their own dudes in place. They don't want to kill those off. So there isn't really a great home for it right now, but that was kind of the same case with Elemental Destruction back when it came out, and I think this card, just like Elemental Destruction, will see play at some point in the metagame. It's good AoE. It's a cool effect. If Bittertide Hydra comes into the metagame, it'll blow people out that way. But yeah, it's a cool, powerful card. I really love the golden animation on this one. I think it's sweet. I like that Control has, you know, these good, straightforward tools now. We'll see how viable Control decks are in a world of combo, but yeah, overall I'm optimistic. All right, next we got Stone Sentinel. So this is a card I'm not too optimistic on. In a vacuum, it's strong. This card would be a two of in every single Elemental Shaman deck if Blaze Caller didn't exist, which is the 7-mana neutral Shaman card. There's only so many 7-drops you want to play. You could play the full 4. There's actually more than 4. I believe there's some neutrals you want to consider too. But Stone Sentinel gives you like a fairly powerful on-curve play on 7, but it doesn't output that much damage. And it's, compared to Blaze Caller, just much, much weaker, right? If you're behind on the board in any significant way, there is a risk of you dying when you play this, because two, three elementals with taunt is just not nearly enough to stabilize a board where they're threatening to kill you. So Stone Sentinel, like if you want an additional 7-drop guy, like you will run him. He's fine. He's not a bad card. He's definitely not weak, but he's no Blaze Caller, and he's definitely not going to kill your opponent very quickly when you're on the proactive plan against combo decks. So it's not really going to change too much about how the elemental deck plays out by virtue of existing. But you know, it's a solid role player card. You can run it in that deck. I wouldn't rush to craft it if you're playing Elemental Shaman. You can play it in most Elemental Shaman lists, but it's not like necessary. There's a lot of cards you got to fit in that deck, like the Jade Package, in my opinion. It's just tough to fit everything like this. All right, next we got Spirit Echo, which is give your minions death rattle, return this to your hand. This is a potentially cool tool for Control Shaman against other control decks. You can play one copy of it, blow them out in the late game, just really have inevitability. But outside of that, niche tool, I mean, it's like playing at least Star Seeker in something, right? It's not going to win you the game on its own in most matchups. It's just kind of a tech tool for the control mirror if those get popular. All right, I've actually saved the last two quests, or the last two legendaries for last. Should have done the quest first, sorry about that. We got Unite the Murlocs, which wants you to summon 10 Murlocs, and the reward is Megafin. So the pure Murloc aggro deck, I think, is not an awful deck, but those are the kinds of decks that usually perform for the first couple days of an expansion just because they're aggro, and then later on they kind of rotate out of the metagame because, well, other decks overtake them. Usually other aggro decks have more efficient minions. Now, this time around, Shaman doesn't really have other aggro tools, right? You'll play the Jade Package, but you can play that with Murlocs. But you don't really have 1-drops and 2-drops in Shaman unless you play the Murloc Package most of the time. It's really tough to develop a good curve for an aggro deck without playing Murlocs. So that alone might make Murloc aggro an actual strategy. This is a card you might keep in every matchup in that deck. Sometimes maybe you'll mull it away in the aggro mirrors. But it's playable, right, as a pure Murloc aggro deck. But the cool thing about Unite the Murlocs is it's actually viable as just part of a package of just very few Murlocs as an anti-control tool, which is what I was trying it as. I played it in a deck where you only play two call in the finishers, two of the Primal Fin Totem, and then the Finja package. So you're only playing, like, a couple of the Murloc cards. Calling in the finishers is obviously the big way to trigger this card. It's the big way to rush it out. And then you have this like really valuable Megafin, right, which is a battle cry, fill your hand with random Murlocs, 5-mana, 8/8. That'll really win control matchups for you. So I was trying it out as like a anti-control tool in that regard. It was going reasonably well. The deck was performing well, but yeah, overall I'm still undecided on the card. It's definitely not unplayable. It's just gonna depend on where Murlocs overall fit into the metagame. I think the condition is definitely a lot harder to hit than some of the other quests, but payoff is solid and Murlocs are not that tough to play. If you're playing a Murloc deck, that's most of your deck anyway. You're gonna get your Megafin reliably at some point. It's just not gonna be turn five. Still undecided. It's gonna on the power level of the archetype overall. The quest is like decent though. It's not unplayable. Right. Finally, we have Kalamos the Primal Lord. If you played an Elemental last turn, cast Elemental Invocation. This card is nuts. This is like the reason to play Elementals. Every single thing you can pull off this is absolutely busted. You can pull more of these off of the 5-drop neutral that discovers elementals. Kalamos is just nuts. I mean, there's not much to say about this card. It's good in every situation. Card's busted. It's the whole reason to play Elemental Shaman. Moving on, I'm gonna grab a water bottle. We're gonna get to Warlock. Let's start with the quest this time, as intended. We got Lakari's Sacrifice, which is a 1-mana. Well, they're all 1-mana. It's a quest where you discard 6 cards. The reward is Nether Portal. Nether Portal is a 5-mana portal that takes up a board slot. And then you open up the portal and you get 2 Flame Imps on either side of it at the end of every turn. So I kind of reviewed this card when I did my Clutch Mother Zavas card reveal, which you guys can check out. Hopefully one of the editors can link that over here. Wow. In that reveal, I basically said Lakari Sacrifice doesn't strike me as a very good card. Even in a control-heavy metagame, I don't think you're going to want this kind of effect. I think the card's pretty crappy. And if you want a more in-depth explanation as to why, feel free to check out that video. But yeah, in a nutshell, it's just even against control, you'd rather be playing other stuff. Against aggro, you're not going to keep it in your hand. The only good thing about this card is that you're not going to feel bad about discarding it in your discard deck. So, yeah. The other legendary, which I'll just jump right to, is Clutch Mother Zavas, which is a pretty sweet card. This is like Clutch Mother is the new, iteration of Silverware Golem, and the fact that you can play a third copy of a Silverware Golem effect makes a discard deck so much more reliable than it used to be. This is now 50% more Silverware Golem. Now, whether the discard version of Zoo will end up being the actual best one is still up in the air. I've been having a lot of success with Token Zoo personally. The discard one's also strong. It's going to take some refinement to figure out the best list, but point is, she's a good card. And this card you'll auto include in your discard Zoo deck, and yeah, this is definitely a big argument for going that archetype with Zoo. And I do think Zoo will be a very strong deck because the early game for other classes rotated out, and Zoo was the best deck in the game for like the first 3 years of Hearthstone, I think. Now that the only metagame where it wasn't the best deck is when patches plus early game weapons existed in every other class in the game that was played, plus Tunnel Trog plus Totem Golem. Even then, Zoo was like kind of okay. Yeah, anyway, I think it's going to be Zoo's time to shine again. I think Zoo will be a tier one deck, at the very least tier two, for a long time to come. And it beats the Cavern deck, so. All right. Anyway, moving on, we got Lakari Fellhound, right? 4-mana, 3/8, Battlecry, discard 2 random cards. I don't really like this card, honestly. I think you're not getting nearly enough stats for the mana. If you compare this to like a 4-mana 7/7, for example. Like, a 4-drop in Zoo has to do a lot, right? If I want to play a 4-mana taunt minion, I'd rather play Argus. Argus gives you 4 or 5 of stats, but two of the stats have charge because you're immediately impacting something. Argus also helps you play around AoE by setting up your minions at the right, with getting them to the right health to where they survive AoE, like swipe. Lakari Fellhound doesn't really output enough damage to kill your opponent quickly, although it does protect your other minions really well. It's a card I'm still really on the fence on. Like, honestly, Zoo just has so little room for 4-drops. I think Defender of Argus is just really key, and in order to include this card in your deck, you would have to cut Defender of Argus for it because they kind of fill a similar role. And this would be for a more like all-in version of Discard Warlock. But overall, I would say this card's unlikely to see play. I don't believe it's too powerful. And I don't think that control discard Warlock will ever be a thing. Cards like this will not make it a thing. Like, discard Warlock has to be more aggressive, in my opinion, to see play. Moving on, I got Ravenous Pterodactyl, Battlecry Destroy friendly minion, adapt twice. This is a 4-drop that I think for the first time is a 4-drop worth including in Zoo since like Gormok. Because for the longest time, Defender of Argus has been the only 4-drop worth playing, partly because, you know, the stats you get up front are very good and you can reliably trigger it on curve, but partly because you want some kind of taunt effect because it wins you matchups like Hunter, Aggro, you know, Pirate Warrior, things like that. Pterodactyl is actually just a sick 4-drop. Like, this card is 4 mana 7/7 power level. You know, sometimes you literally make it a 4 mana 7/7 with adaptations. Sometimes you just go like Stealth Wind Fury. Sometimes you just go like Stealth +1/+1 and make like 4 mana Stranglethorn Tiger. That's like the bad outcome. You know, there's a lot of great things you can do with this card. It's super powerful. I think this should be an inclusion in most Zoo decks. It's an excellent 4-drop for Zoo, and yeah, I expect to play it a lot. It's you know, not the most busted 4-drop they've ever made for Zoo. It's not like Voidwalker power level, but or Voidcaller, but it's pretty good. All right, next we got Tarlurker. This is a cool elemental. I mean, this will see play in Kazakus versions of Warlock. I don't know if it's even good enough for Handlock, honestly. I don't know if you have a room for an effect like this. Maybe you do. Yeah, I mean, a 4/7 for 5 taunt is damn strong, and the elemental tag on this can't be ignored, that's for sure. I think there's a lot of insanely powerful control tools in the metagame now, and I think a card like Tarlurker would have been played in like every Reno deck, for example, in the last expansion. It's a matter of in the last season. It's just a matter of, like, you know, when everybody has good control tools, which ones end up being the best? Which ones do the aggro decks interact with unfavorably? Tarlurker might be that card, but, you know, if like Kazakus Warlock is just never good enough to see play, we might never see this guy. For what it's worth, though, back in the days of Handlock, because I think that is a deck now again, back in the days of Handlock, we did play Sludge Belcher, and this card is, I mean, it's not as outright broken as Sludge Belcher, but the power level's up there. It's a good card, at least against aggro. Right, next we got Corrupting Mist. Corrupt every minion, destroy them at the start of your next turn. This card sucks in like every single capacity in every way. There's no situation where this will ever be good. Corrupting Mist is just complete and utter trash, and I'm not going to waste time in this video when I have so many more cards to get through to go through the reasons this card is trash. Just dust it. Dust it. Don't think twice about it. All right, next we got Feeding Time. Deal 3 damage, summon 3 Pterodactyls. Okay, if you're playing like a Sea Giant Zoo deck, I would still play Karakazam before I play this 5-drop, and I would probably play Doppelgangster before I play Karakazam. So there's like two shitty 5-drops better than this 5-drop. That it makes me really skeptical if it's worth playing. For what it's worth, it's a proactive spell, so maybe if the Blood Bloom type of, that's a card I'll talk about in a bit, if the Blood Bloom type of strategy. This card sucks. I mean, you might play it as a one of in like Kazakus Warlock, but other than that, it's just too much mana for too little of an effect. Let me tell you about a card called Implosion, all right? This card is not Implosion, even though it hits for 50% more damage. All right. Next, you got Cruel Dinomancer, Death Rattle, summon a random minion you discarded this game. I mean, this is the kind of card, just like Fellhound, that I think is more intended for defensive discard Warlock decks. I mean, I can try building one, I still haven't, but I just assume those kinds of decks will be pretty weak, right? Compared to Handlock, compared to Kazakus Warlock, just slower Warlock decks, other slow Warlock decks, there's no way this is the best one, right? It can't be. I'm really skeptical about this card. I mean, to be fair, the stats you're getting out of it are like pretty good a lot of the time, but it's, you can't play it in Zoo, right? You're gonna get like a 2/2 out of it. It's just generally a pretty underwhelming card, and I don't expect this to see any play, and I don't think defensive discard Warlock decks will be a thing. This is not nearly strong enough to make them a thing. All right, next we got Blood Bloom. The next spell you cast this turn costs health instead of mana. This kind of card is Interesting. I mean, it's like one of those, you know, it's the Cho'Gall effect. It's a card that has this unique effect that they introduce into the game that isn't nearly enough to make an archetype on its own, but maybe at some point in the future, after a couple expansions, there will be a reason to run it, right? Maybe in some kind of combo deck, maybe in some kind of control deck. I think being able to play like a Twisting Nether for two cards and a million life, maybe that makes it good enough for Kazakus. I think Kazakus is the main synergy with this, right? You can play a 10 mana Kazakus potion for 2 mana and 10 life, and that's kind of insane sometimes. I mean, that alone can win you games. I don't know if that interaction is enough to really warrant playing this on its own. It's going to take time to figure out. It's really like a really awkward self-harming innervate in a lot of ways. Yeah, it's going to take time to see if this is worthwhile to run, but my guess is it's more like a gimmick card, more of a, you know, unique effect introduced to the game for the sake of having a card that does this. And this is the one to keep an eye out on, you know, a couple expansions down the line or for some wild decks. At some point, this kind of mechanic might see play. Maybe they'll decide to push it really hard the way they did with discard at some point. And then finally, we got Chittering Tunneler, which is a 3-mana 3-3 beast. Again, it's the first expansion that they've put in 3-mana 3-3s that draw cards. The closest thing we had before this was the 3-2 for 3 that turns something into a chicken that he draws. Anyway, Chittering Tunneler, discover a spell, deal damage to your hero equal to its cost. All right, so you lose a lot of life, but man, discovering a spell is so powerful. It's so good, and you're getting decent stats on curve, auto-include in all the Kazakus decks. I'm even thinking about playing this card in Zoo. I mean, it's just a strong card. Like, it's a beast too, right? So you can curator it out, which matters in some wonky builds, I'm sure, you know. It's an interesting card. I don't know. Chittering Tunneler, the power level's there to see constructed play at some point. There's no clear-cut deck or place for it just yet, though. Moving on to Warrior, the last class before we get to the neutrals. Start off with the quest. Fireplume's Heart. Quest, play 7 taunt minions. Reward, Sulfurous. All right, so this card, right? When I reviewed the Priest quest, I said it sucked because the reward is bad against control, and the quest will only be completed in a control matchup. Fireplume's Heart, right? This reward is good against control. It gives you inevitability. You get Ragnaros hero power. You will win the late game. And it triggers in control matchups. So here you have a card that is an excellent quest, an excellent quest. You're doing something you want to do anyway. Just playing Taunt Idiots. Your reward is a late game card that wins you late game matchups. This is an example of a really powerful quest. I said this, you know, in my last review as well. This is an excellent, excellent card. I'm just going to move on through. I mean, the deck kind of builds itself, right? You play Taunt Minions, you curve out with them. Sulfurous gives you that inevitability in control matchups the way that Justicar and Elise gave you before. And then the stuff you're doing to fulfill the quest is good against aggro anyway, although in aggro matchups, I think you mulligan this away most likely. All right, anyway, Ironhide, right? First warrior, or next warrior card I'm going to review. 1 mana, gain 5 armor. There really isn't a place for this kind of effect. I think, you know, in like a Gadgetzan Auctioneer type of warrior deck, this might see some amount of play. I've played a lot of Blood Warrior. It's the only deck I can see this being played in. It'll reduce the cost of Arcane Giant, keep you alive a little bit longer, trigger Pyromancer. Like, it does all these things, and it's cute, but whether that's strong enough at the end of the day is really up in the air. I like the card. I think it's strong. It's just, well, I mean, I like the card. I like that deck. I think the Blood Warrior deck can be strong. I think this card is not strong at all. This is just, like, fairly weak, only interacts with your life total. You can't even target your opponent's stuff the way you can with like Flash, Heal, Soul Priest. But it's just like a role player card that at some point will be played in something. These cards always are. They'll find a place at some point. Right now there's no deck for it though, and it's probably just too weak to see play. Next we got Ornery Direhorn. Taunt, battle cry, adapt. Let me Google the word ornery because it sounds ridiculous. Bad-tempered and combative. Okay. Thought it was just like a southern drawl thing for ordinary or something. All right, well, Ornery Direhorn. Compared to Sunwalker, this is most of the time going to be worse. You know, I would like to guarantee having Divine Shield on my Taunt Idiot. And Sunwalker is a card that's probably not good enough to see play in the deck anyway. So I think for the most part, this is just like a strong arena card, but not going to really see play in Constructed at all. And there's a better option in neutral already. Most of the adaptations are going to be worse than Divine Shield. You can just have the Divine Shield and one less attack. Yeah, I don't expect this to see too much play. All right, next we got Tar Lord, which is like Warrior's Ancient of War. It's a pretty big card. Like, if you really want more taunt minions, this is the one that just ends the game against aggro on the spot. But as a 7-drop, the fact that it doesn't do anything offensive means it's going to be really underwhelming in the control matchup. It's going to still protect your other minions, but it's other control decks don't mind just taking one damage a turn and then not committing resources to dealing with this. Like, they don't need to be attacking with their minions. So I think it'll be a tech choice against aggro, but I don't expect this card to really see like mainstream two of an everything play. It's definitely an interesting card though. I mean, it's a 5/11 for 7. Jesus. Tar Lord was an inside job. All right, moving on, we got Molten Blade. Each turn is in your hand, transform it into a new weapon. First time I saw this card, I really felt like it was strong. I felt like, okay, well, most of the weapons in Standard are like pretty powerful. You don't mind getting True Silver Champions and stuff like that. And maybe in a control deck, this can give you essentially more copies of Fiery War Axe in a way. But then after thinking about it more, I think the card's actually pretty weak. And I haven't played with it yet. I haven't seen it be played. But my opinion on it, in my last review, I said this too. I kind of went through the whole thought process. I think it's good if it's in your opening hand. Like if you get it in your opening hand, it's a constructed playable card. But the reason it's not a constructed playable card overall is because half the time you're going to draw it off the top in the mid game and in the late game. And if it's not in your hand from the opening, you're going to get so many fewer random flips on it that it's just going to be too long until you find a reasonable weapon. So I think overall Molten Blade is, I mean, it's an interesting card, but I mean, Warrior has so many good tools now that you just don't need to play cards like this. You have no need for it. There's so many other busted things you can be playing. So I feel like Molten Blade is really just underwhelming, and it's not a card that's really going to have a home. But the power level is there if you're really good at drawing it opening hand every time. All right. Moving on, we got Cornered Sentry. Taunt, Battlecry, summon three Raptors for your opponent. There's a lot of synergy with this card that wasn't immediately apparent. You can run it the same way that I ran Leeroy and Grim Patron, as in like you play Cornered Sentry and then you like attack with Acolyte of Pain, or you attack with a guy that has an enrage mechanic. That definitely has synergy. I think the most obvious one is, you know, using it with Brawl. A lot of people initially compared this card to Dirty Rat just because the stats are the same, but I think the cards are completely different. Like, you play Dirty Rat for the Battlecry, and you play this card for the stats, and also for making your brawls guaranteed to be good. This and Dirty Rat both make your brawls good, but this is, like, better for brawling, I think. As far as, like, having a home, I think, you know, you're not really going to play it outside of Control Warrior, Taunt Warrior. Maybe you'll run it in like a tempo-oriented warrior deck that really wants your opponent to have dudes that you can attack, but I just don't really see any minions that you really want to be bumping into stuff other than Acolyte of Pain. And we had Grim Patron rotate out, so that definitely hurts the card's viability too. Yeah, I think if anything, it'll be like a one of in Control Warrior sometimes if you really want another Brawl Enabler, but definitely not a necessary card. All right, next we got Direhorn Hatchling. It's Fen Creeper and a Death Rattle. Shuffle is a 6/9 Direhorn with Taunt into your deck. And that 6/9 also costs 5 mana. So Fen Creeper is pretty underwhelming, but when you take into account the fact that the Warrior Quest is to play 7 Taunt minions, you're going to want just decent ones at every point in the curve. Direhorn Hatchling gives you pretty much as good as you can do with a card for turn 5. The stats are passable in the control matchups. You're going to get, you know, a 6/9 really late game. That's important just in the attrition war. You can get the 6/9 out of your deck with Curator, which is another good taunt minion that you want to be playing anyway. So I think for the most part, this will make the cut in Taunt Warrior. I think the card is solid. It's reasonable. Yeah, just a decent, role player card in the deck that will see constructed play. Next, we got Explore Un'Goro for the memes. Really cool card, cool artwork. I mean, this card's sweet. I don't know. I think it's one of those fun cards like Renounce the Darkness that I can stream when I'm extremely drunk and or mad at the game, and I will enjoy doing so. But definitely not competitively viable, even with any potential Gadgets and Auctioneer scenarios. All right, next we got Sudden Genesis. I think I've played more Blood Warrior than any human being alive, and I can tell you that the last thing the deck needs to be good is more Blood Warriors. You have enough Blood Warriors. I can try this card, but it's not as good as Blood Warrior with Arcane Giant. I'd rather just have the card cost 3 mana and give them to my hand because they cost 0 mana anyway. This card is just not Echo of Medivh. It's not like there might be some kind of synergy with this late game that just makes it an insane combo enabler in some kind of deck at some point, but right now I'm just not seeing it. I don't think there's really a place for the deck, and I think that even in the Blood Warrior deck, I'd rather be playing other stuff instead of this. And then finally, we got King Mosh, the other legendary in the class. So at first I thought, it's a pretty weak card. Battlecry, destroy all damaged minions. Obviously there's the Whirlwind synergy, which everyone's going to bring up, but it's a 9-mana 9/7, and you want to play your Whirlwinds before turn 10, and if I want a 10-mana AoE, I can just play like a Deathwing or whatever. The point is, I thought about this card more, and I think it might actually have a place in some lists, and the reason for that is, first of all, it executes just a busted type of effect, being able to kill anything. You want to feel comfortable playing those early and still having like a late game way to deal with a big dude. But the big reason I think this might see play is just the fact that it's a beast. The fact that I can pull this out of my deck with a Curator, which is a card that looks to be a staple of Control Warrior with, because it's a taunt minion that gets you more taunt minions. That alone might make King Mosh like a tech call in some lists that you can play as like a one of. Definitely not a bad card. I think it has some potential and, it's definitely playable. It's going to give you more of an edge in the control matchups than the aggressive ones. And I don't think you want to be playing double Whirlwind in most lists, but it's a card to keep an eye out for. It's just like another option for control. Definitely don't rush to craft this, though, if you're playing Control Warrior. You don't need it. All right, moving on to the neutrals. So starting off, we got Spirit Singer Umbra. I think that this card is, stat-wise, right, it's pretty much the same as Bran. What matters on these cards is the health, not the attack, because you care about the ability. The fact that you're paying one more mana is just such a big drawback. Death Rattles are only slightly more powerful than Battle Cries. And even though Bran is just this card that became ubiquitous towards the end of the format, it was a card that was just at the right power level to like see a lot of play. It was just like a little bit too strong. The fact that this card costs one more mana is just like super weak. In control matchups, this might be a way to give you inevitability and make sure that you win those games somehow, but I think you can't just throw it into your deck as a value guy in multiple archetypes the way that people could with Bran. Power level is just not quite there. I don't think any synergy with living mana or anything like that matters at all. I would probably recommend just disenchanting this card if you open it. Next, we got the Vorax. After you cast a spell on a minion, summon a 1/1 planet, cast a copy on it. Yeah, this is obviously might as well be a Paladin card. You're not going to play it in anything aside from the Kaleidosaur Paladin quest deck. In that deck, you can't really play it turn 4. That's the awkward thing here. It's kind of like Ginny of Zephyrs with worse stats. Like, you have to play it as a 5-mana or a 6-mana card. And at that point, it's very likely you've lost the board already. It's a card that I will start by including into the Kaleidosaur deck, but as it gets refined, I wouldn't be surprised to see it get cut altogether. This card doesn't feel very powerful to me at all. I think the stats should have been better. I think the stats should be like 3-4. But yeah, it's an interesting card. It's a weird effect. It's just, I think it's too easy to kill. I think unless you adapt it with stealth right away, it's going to be pretty underwhelming. All right, next we got Elise the Trailblazer, Battlecry, Shuffler, Sealed, and Goro Pack in your deck. I love the flavor on this card. I think it's really cool. The stats are worse than Pit Fighter, so I wouldn't play it in any aggressive or mid-range deck. This is more of a card that you play the same way you played the old Elise, where you're expecting to go to Fatigue and Control Mirrors, so you want a card that gives you more cards for the fatigue game. I think that's the only case it'll see competitive play. But I like the flavor behind it. I really like the mechanic. I think it's a really fun card. But yeah, unless you're looking to tech in something in your control deck because you're going to fatigue a lot and you want another card for those matchups, this isn't a card you're going to really need. All right, next we have Hemet Jungle Hunter. This card's sweet. It's a really unique effect. We haven't really seen a card like this at all before. I'm going through all the legendaries first, sorry. Hemet's just powerful as hell. I mean, this is a card that will inevitably see play in some strategies. You can run this in certain combo decks with cheesy stuff like Holy Wrath, but just outside of that, you can run Hemet in. What I've run him in is like aggro druid, right? I play out my early game. Sometimes I'll innervate this guy out on turn four or something, and then the rest of my deck will just be swipes and living mana and Leeroy. And at that point, like you play Hemet, you play a 6/6. They spend a turn killing him. You draw living mana. You go all in. That should kill them, right? It's a very like balls to the wall. Like it's like an ultimatum. You know, it's a last chance to just cheese the game. And I think it wins you games no other card can in a lot of cases. And that alone is just really powerful. So I'm optimistic about this card. I think it will find a home in some things, but there isn't like a clear-cut place where it's correct to be running him right now. Now finally, we've got Ozrook, who has dat ass if you play elementals. Yeah, I mean it's a big animal. I don't think any elemental like okay, all the elemental decks are really easy to build as just traditional control decks where they're really slow, they gain a bunch of life, they kill a bunch of stuff, they play a bunch of taunts. Those kinds of decks don't tend to be very competitive in Hearthstone because they don't do anything broken. They're just very fair. The broken decks are the ones that, you know, do degenerate stuff. Miracle Rogue, aggro decks that kill you turn four, just whatever, you know, Jade Druid. So just by virtue of 4 years of experience in Hearthstone, I would say that this kind of strategy is not quite likely to be competitive, but it's not too bad of a card. I mean, you can get some crazy stat lines with this guy. There's a lot of elementals that add elementals to your hand. You can really make him ridiculously sized, but you know, it's nothing that you can't do with like a single Divine Spirit out of Priest, for example, too. It's yeah. It's an interesting card. I don't think most elemental decks even need to be playing him though necessarily. But you know, maybe I'm off about him. It's gonna take some time to find out what an optimal elemental deck looks like. All right, so I just went through the legendaries. I'm gonna go through the rarities kind of backwards. I'm gonna go through epics next. And we're gonna start with Charged Devilsaur, the 8-mana 7/7 beast. With charge, Battlecry can't attack heroes this turn. So this mechanic of having charge but not being able to attack heroes is already in Shadowverse. This is actually a mechanic they copied from Shadowverse that's had it for a while. Which is a different card game. You guys might see me streaming sometimes. I put videos on the channel once in a while for it. In that game, it's called Rush, and it's a really cool way to balance charge, where you know you don't have any problems with like OTKs or just killing your opponent out of nowhere, but you still get that immediate board control. Yeah, so it's a lot like Ice Howl in a way. I think competitive-wise, this card isn't gonna do too much. You're not gonna put it in any deck on purpose, but it's a cool mechanic that I hope they experiment more with, and sometimes you'll kill somebody with this card if you get it off the priest spell that discovers him, because then the Battlecry doesn't matter. But yeah, cool mechanic. Hope they play with this more. Next, I'm going to go to Bright-Eyed Scout, which is a 4-mana 3/4 Battlecry draw card, changes cost to 5. So Gnomish Inventor is a card that has seen play in Hearthstone historically, not recently since Minions got a lot better, but drawing cards is nothing to scoff at. This guy has better stats than Gnomish Inventor, like much better stats. Thank God he's not a 3/5. That would be so tilting. Then you just get cheesed so often, but it's a really high variance card, right? It's a 4-mana 3/4. You get a 5-cost card. You're not going to include him in random combo decks like Miracle Rogue because you don't want your preparations costing 5 or whatever. But in a dedicated cheesy ramp deck, you can really high roll some people with this. Whatever you draw off of it, you can play the next turn. Since she costs 4, your draw costs 5. So if you get like a giant Anaconda or like any like massive taunt idiot or just something in a big Druid ramp deck, this card could be really effective. So I think, like, you know, as a Astral Communion cheese type of card, this can do a lot, but outside of that, it's not too strong. It's not going to just be included in every single deck. It's definitely like a cool niche role player card in certain archetypes. All right, next we got Emerald Hive Queen, which is a 1-mana 2/3 beast. Your minions now cost 2 more. This is a card that is pretty interesting in multiple ways. I've tried it in Quest Hunter, actually, as like the last one drop you play. Works well with Stampede as well. It's really at its strongest when you're a deck that has weapons. Things like Jade Claw are the best follow-up in theory, right? Jade Claw into Feral Spirit or something like that. It's a card that's not unplayable, but it's definitely like awkward in certain decks. There's no clear spot where you want to include it. I think that in the Kaleidoscore Quest Paladin deck, that's definitely a place where you can make some good use of it, follow it up with some buffs, play this turn one, turn two play the quest, and then buff it, for example. It's a card that I like being in the game because 1-mana 2/3s are always busted in one way or another, like they'll see play. But this one has a really open-ended condition that is kind of up to the deck builder on, you know, where do you put it? How do you take advantage of it? Yeah, I think, you know, in that sense, it's a pretty interesting, cool card. We'll see where it ends up seeing play. Moving on, we got Gluttonous Ooze, 3-mana, 3/3, battlecry, destroy your opponent's weapon, gain armor equal to its attack. A lot of people were hyping this card up for some reason, like this was fucking the second coming of Jesus. I don't know, man. Gluttonous Ooze was never a card that I thought was good. I don't think it's good at all. If you want an anti-pirate card, you'll play Galaka Crawler. If you want an anti-weapon card, you'll play Acidic Ooze. There's no sideboarding in Hearthstone, so you have to like main deck a card in order to include weapon, like an anti-weapon hate card. Harrison Jones is going to be better most of the time. The times that Harrison Jones isn't better, you'd rather be playing Acidic Ooze. Because Acidic Ooze has like the same stats, but it costs 50% less mana, you know? Like, it's the Acidic Ooze trades with the same stuff. It costs 50% less mana. Like, that's such a big deal for the matchups where they don't have a weapon. I mean, to be fair, this card's like way swingier in the matchups where you do want that weapon destruction, so it's going to like gain you. It's going to do more to like single-handedly win you the game than Ooze will. You know, in a deck like Warlock that cares a lot about life gain, maybe I'll play both. Maybe I'll play this Ooze instead of Acidic. But overall, like, you know, it's a niche card. I don't expect it to see too much play. It's a cool tool to have in the arsenal, but I don't think this card will be seen very much at all. It's like, people get hyped about crap like this and Eater of Secrets all the time. Like, these cards are just not, meh. Not anything special, you know? It's not going to change anything. We already have these tools available. All right, next we got Gentle Megazord, Battlecry, Adapter, Murlocs, 4-mana, 5/4 beast. This card's pretty spicy. You can run it in Paladin or Shaman. Those are like the two go-to Murloc decks now. And this one does just kill your opponent. I mean, if you have like two Murlocs in play, Gentle Megazord just wins you the game on turn four. Yeah, it's strong as hell. You should play it in your Murloc decks, and you should not play it in your non-Murloc decks. There's not much to say about it outside of that. From there, we got Bitter Tide Hydra. So this is kind of, a lot of people compare this to Fellreaver for good reason. Fellreaver is a card I was really high on when I did my GVG set review. That's a card I rated as my number three card in the set. This card is not Fellreaver. The thing about Fellreaver is it was insane against control, and it was also insane against aggro because it just won you the race. Bitter Tide Hydra is like still good against control. In fact, Bitter Tide Hydra is better against control than Fellreaver was, but it's worse against aggro. It's a lot more punishing to, you know, drop this in a matchup that comes down to racing because they can trade into it and still get that all that damage to your face. It's almost like playing both in the matchup. You know, they get to kill it, but they also get to not lose an attack for it. I don't know, it's like a bad example, but the point is, this card's worse than Fellreaver overall by a pretty significant margin. But despite that, it's still capable of just winning you the game on its own. It has Beast Synergy, which is super relevant. I mean, this has Synergy with the Jungle Giant's quest, This has synergy with Menagerie Warden, so it makes a lot of sense to try it in Druid. You can run it even in things like Pirate Warrior, just as the same way that I run Living Mana and Aggro Druid. You can run this in Pirate Warrior as like a plan B to just kill them. There's a lot of opportunity to run this card. I expect it to see some amount of play moving forward. Next, we got Blaze Caller. This card's basically Firelands Portal. This card's great. I mean, if you're playing an Elemental deck, for the most part, if you have a curve that goes to 7, you should be playing 2 of this card. Like, unless your whole deck costs like 5 mana or less, this is a card you should include. It's really, really strong. The stats are fantastic. It's an Elemental itself, so you can keep the Elemental chain going after playing it. Yeah, so not much to say about it. It's a great card. Play it in your Elemental decks. 2 of it. Tortolin Primalist. I'm so glad that this card sucks. These are the kinds of cards where, 2 expansions ago, Blizzard would just make them cost like 4 mana. And they'd be like, yeah, sure, it has a drawback, kind of. And then Constructed would look like a joke for the next, like, year. So I'm glad that they've kind of realized, like, there's no reason these kinds of cards need to be competitively costed. I think this card's, like, pretty bad. It's possible I'm wrong, but I don't think I am. I mean, you're discovering a spell from any class. It's really high variance, obviously, but it might still see competitive play. I don't know. I just really hope it doesn't. I think the card's underpowered, too high variance, and just too underwhelming cost and stat-wise to see play. Plus, it kills itself sometimes. Rarely, but sometimes. I think Constructed is better without these kinds of cards in the game, so... If me saying it's bad will discourage you from bringing it into ladder, I will say it's bad. All right, next we have Primordial Drake. This might be my favorite card in the expansion. I don't know if it's the strongest, but it's definitely my favorite card. This is like the control tool I've wanted in the game since the beginning. 8 mana, 4/8 taunt. 2 damage to all their minions and dragon synergy. This card does everything. Stops you from dying to weapons. Clears the board so they can't just trade guys into your taunt effectively. Has a fat pile of stats, a fat ass. It does everything. You pull it off Curator. This card is sick. It has a quality synergy and Control Paladin. Did I mention you pull it off Curator? That's such a big deal. It has quest synergy in the Warrior deck. It has synergy in any class playing against Priest because it beats them because it's a 4/8. Like, this card's sick. I don't know. I'm a really big fan of it. Loves playing with this card. I'm going to be playing it for a long time, and I think it's just going to be a core control tool for a long time to come. All right, next we got Glaukka Crawler. This card's pretty sweet, man. I don't know. I think a 2-mana 2/3 is kind of like the new shielded mini-bot in Standard. The 2-drops just kind of suck. So this card's stats are fine. You can just main deck it and Hunter just to have a good on-curve beast. And, the upside when it hits is just going to deliver the sweet taste of justice all over Garrosh's face. This is just so satisfying to kill pirates with, man. I'm glad it's in the game. I think it's a cool tech tool. And, yeah, the stats on it are solid. It'll be a role player in decks once in a while that really want a 2-mana 2/3 beast. Mostly Hunter. Maybe Druid would play it. Unlikely, but maybe just like one. Yeah. All right, next we got Stonehill Defender. This is a card I did a really big 180 on. In my original set review, I said this card would be pretty mediocre, and I thought the only thing it would see play in is Control Paladin, because you get 3 broken legendaries. Like, the discover rate on class cards is way higher, and all the Paladin taunts are Tyrion, Sunkeeper, Tarim, and then Wicker Flame. So you get, like, insane Paladin cards off this. But outside of that, I thought it would be bad in other classes. But as it turns out, it's actually pretty strong in Warrior as well. It gets you 2 taunts for your quest, just endless value. It's like passable against aggro and really good against control. Drawing cards is sweet, man. I don't know. This is a fantastic turtle. If you're playing control decks, you should definitely be running this guy. He's like very, very strong. He also discovers the dragon, Primordial Drake, which, again, I love that card. Always feels good to do that. All right, next we got Devilsore Egg. Deathrattle Summon a 5/5 Devilsore. I mean, this card is like so much worse than Nerubian Egg, it's laughable. Okay, sure, it has the synergy with the 4-mana Zoo guy, Ravenous Pterodax, but It's just so much weaker overall as a card, not only because it costs 50% more than Ruby and Egg, but also because your power overwhelming is rotated out, right? So when you play Devil Sword Egg, you're kind of forced to play Abusive Sergeants in the same deck. You don't always necessarily want to play Abusive Sergeant. It's just a really questionable card. Like to not affect the board at all on three mana is really sketchy, but it does protect you against AoE pretty well. It's a card I really have to play with more to see if it's good. It might just be the case that even though it's a worse in Ruby and Egg, it's still just core in Zoo. That's something that's going to take me time to figure out. It's not unplayable. And there are definitely synergies available with this card, but it's going to take time to really figure out what the optimal build of Zoo is, because right now I have like four builds of Zoo that all have like roughly the same win rate. They're all really strong. It's just going to take a lot of time to refine it. But this card might end up being in the best list. We'll see. Outside of Zoo, which is what I keep talking about, I don't really think there's a place for this deck in anything else, though. You could play it in theory in like the Paladin buff deck, but even there, it's kind of questionable. All right, next we got Vicious Fledgling. After this minion attacks a hero, adapt. This card is unplayable, and I'm going to move on with my life. Humongous Razorleaf. Needs to check his male privilege. This card is a 3-mana 4/8. Can't attack. Damn. This card's incredible. Ancient Watcher has been a, you know, archetype-defining card back in beta in the early days. And having a second version of it that you can play on curve is so sick. This card is so much better than Ancient Watcher when it comes to the 4-drop enablers like Spellbreaker, Keeper of the Grove, Defender of Argus. Getting the extra stats, like this card alone enables a lot of cool archetypes to exist. I think this makes Handlock much more viable and an actual like reasonable strategy. The only reason Reno is better before is because control, like slow Warlock deck's biggest weakness is lack of healing, and Reno gave it healing. So now that the Kazakus Warlock deck and the Handlock deck both suck at healing, now that means Handlock is actually a lot more viable, because comparatively to Kazakus, it's no longer strictly worse. Anyway, this card enables Handlock to be really strong as well. It gives you a nice proactive play turn 3. You can easily, you know, build a wall, make your opponent pay for it. It's really just powerful. Like, not only for Handlock, but for Silence Priest, this makes that strategy pretty viable too. You just didn't really have enough good stuff to silence before. I mean, I've played a lot of Silence Druid back in the day, but I was silencing like Death Lords and Ogre Brutes. This card puts all of those to shame. This card's busted. Like, it's so big. It's definitely going to enable a lot of archetypes. I think Purify can be played non-ironically and be decent. That deck will dumpster aggro at least. It's a good card. All right, next we got Tolvir Stone Shaper. Battlecry, I've played an elemental last turn, gain Taunt and Vine Shield. Yeah, there aren't that many other elemental duders that you want to trigger on turn 4. There aren't that many other things that reward you for playing elementals turn 4, which is kind of the strength of Tolvir. He's definitely strong in that regard. I mean, you know, getting Taunt and Divine Shield for 4 mana is actually absurd. It's really tough for a lot of classes to deal with, and it's just a great minion. But as a drawback, I think a lot of the elemental decks are really reliant on the next card I'm going to talk about, which is Servant of Kalamos, which is a 5-mana elemental that discovers an elemental if you played one last turn. Tolvir Stone Shaper, the card I'm talking about now, the 4-drop, he's weaker because he interrupts your 5-mana elemental. So you can't just cleanly curve them all into each other. So you're playing Tolvir turn 4, but then you're like playing something different turn 5, like another 4-drop, and then like weaving in a little Firefly or something. And then when are you playing Servant of Kalamos turn 6? Like, then you're not using all your mana. The point is, he interrupts the elemental curve. That's what I don't like about this card. It's tough to justify him in a pure elemental deck. The other elemental decks also kind of have other 4-drop options in a lot of cases. For example, Shaman's going to have, you know, Jade Lightning, Jade Spirit if you want to go all in on Jades. They're going to have Jinyu Water Speaker. Now, this card is, you know, not better than those things. So, Yeah, I think it's unlikely he sees too much play, but you know, maybe in like Kazakus elemental decks or something. We'll see. Right, next we got Servant of Kalamos. This is like one of my favorite elemental cards. I think this is really a lot of the payoff of incorporating a neutral elemental package into a deck. Azurdrake's out of the game. You want good five drops. You want five drops to give you value. This thing has bigger stats. This gets you insane elementals because the class elementals are busted. When you play this card in Shaman, like the odds of getting an Alakir or a Kalamos is so stupidly high. It's a great card. So, yeah, core part of elemental packages, really high tier. I like this card a lot. All right, Frozen Crusher. After this minion attacks, freeze it. That is a 6-mana, 8/8 pile of dust. Cool effect though. I don't know. I hope they incorporate that more often. It makes you think about attacking a little bit more. And next we got Volcanosaur. So unfortunately I missed Volcanosaur Day while I was traveling too. I wanted to play on Volcanosaur Day when we could play this card as like the only card from Un'Goro. Didn't get a chance though. It would have been fun. All right. That is the last rare. I think, oh sorry, for as far as how competitive it is though, I think Volcanosaur is not very competitive and constructed. There's just better things to do with that much mana. He's not really going to see play in any decks, in my opinion. All right, so let's go into the commons. So first off, we have Firefly. 1 mana, 1/2, add a 1/2 elemental to your hand. This is like a god tier one drop, and in my original review before having played the set, it was also my opinion. This card's incredible. I mean, a 1 mana 1/2 is a reasonable stat line these days because they're just less busted 1 mana minions. So not only does it interact favorably with other 1-drops like, you know, Alley Cat and stuff like that, but it operates as a 2-drop just fine. You're essentially playing Echoing Ooze turn 2, which again just has fine stats, and that's a card that was completely fine to play on Curve, you know, in Zoo back in the day. So it has just the amount of flexibility that a card like Dark Peddler or Hydrologist has, in that you can play it at multiple spots on a curve, and at no point in the curve is it like a weak play. But it also, you know, that's before we even get into the elemental synergy with the card, right? This enables 2 turns of elementaling. This has synergy in every elemental deck that you're playing. This has synergy in the Cavern of Secret or whatever, the, you know what I mean, the cavern, the quest rogue deck. You can shadow step and get a bunch of elementals in your hand, like with all your pandas and stuff. It has synergy just in so many ways. In Zoo, it has synergy with Knife Juggler. It just fills in the curve of whatever you're playing. It synergizes with multiple decks in multiple ways. This card will see play in a lot of different decks and for a lot of different reasons. And I just expect to see this card being played a ton moving forward. Definitely worth, you know, playing. All right, next we got Glacial Shard. Battlecry, freeze an enemy on a 1-mana 2/1 elemental. That's a crazy card, dude. They're power creeping the original Murloc 2/1 quite a bit. Glacial Shard's powerful as hell, man. This card is, I mean, that's an effect that we've played before just on spells, right? Freezing Potion, Ice Lance targeting a minion. You're getting a dude on top of that. You're getting an elemental trigger on top of that. You're getting a lot of synergy with Shadow Steps in the Quest Rogue deck if you're playing it in that specifically as well. This is a card that will see constructed play. I think right now, mostly the Quest Rogue deck is where it's going to fit. I don't think you should be putting it in random like elemental shaman decks yet, but it's a powerful card. We'll see a lot of it in different places moving forward. All right, next we got Emerald Reaver. Battlecry, deal 1 damage to each hero. I guess this is their attempt at balancing Leper Gnome. Card's pretty underwhelming. I mean, you don't want to play crap like this just to make your Hunter Quest good, because your Hunter Quest just isn't good. Even the payoff on the Hunter Quest sucks. Like, you never have to draw the Raptors right away. God, I hate that card so much. Emerald Reaver is pretty underwhelming, I would say, overall, right? Like, even in the face Hunter decks, I think you'd rather have 1-drops that just give you more board presence, like Alley Cat. This thing's not going to interact favorably with other things that are popular. For example, Firefly being played, right? You get 2-for-1 by Firefly pretty hard when you play this thing. It does have beast synergy, so it's got that going for it, but overall, I don't really expect this card to see too much play, and I think it's gonna be pretty underwhelming. All right, next we got Rabosaur Runt. This is another one of the cards I did a complete 180 on. In my original review, I thought this card would be pretty mediocre. I thought it would be pretty tough to have two minions in play by turn two, and it's just not that strong. In reality, I think Rabosaur Runt is like, I'm so high on this card. Like, I think it's like, I thought the card would be like down here, and I think most people think it's like right here. And I think the card is actually like up here and how good it is. Like, I think it's so strong. This is like the future of Shield and Minibot, man. I was putting the Bloodsail Corsair patches package, which I thought was just mediocre and not good enough for any deck before. I put it in everything now because of this guy. I put it in Aggro Druid. I put it in so much stuff. Like, I put it in Zoo now because, like, I didn't think it was good enough before Rabosaur Runt, and now with Rabosaur Runt, it is good enough. I mean, this card is like Shielded Minibot levels of busted, but it's better than Shielded Minibot when you activate it. Like, sure, you can get Divine Shield, but sometimes you get the plants, and it's like a better Haunted Creeper, or you just get Attack, and it's like a 5-2 for 2, or you get Health, and it's a 2-5 for 2. The things you can do with this card are just nuts. Like, on turn 2, okay, in a metagame where there is so much shitty early game and everyone's early game sucks, you just have this guy, which is just like better than Minibot a lot of the time. And even when you don't play him turn two, you just play a different two drop turn two, and then turn three you go one drop Rabosaur Run. That's still nuts. Like, this card is so good. I'm really impressed by this card. I think in Wild this might start becoming an auto include in a bunch of stuff just because of how easy it is to get tokens in that format. But yeah, it's a nuts card. It's really, really, really good, and I'm highly optimistic about this card moving forward. I think this will be metagame defining for a lot of aggressive decks. And it's a beast, like, just because why not draw cards off Marquee Charge? All right, next we got Stubborn Gastropod, Taunt Poisonous. Yeah, it's a pretty interesting effect. I gave a more in-depth, God, I gave such a longer winded response on so many of these cards in my original review. I'm really sad that that file got corrupted. This one feels a lot lazier comparatively. Stubborn Gastropod is powerful. I mean, the taunt and the fact that it has two health, I mean, really the poisonous more than the taunt means it can't be ignored for a turn. The extra health means it won't die to hero powers, so you're trading it for a weapon charge or an actual card. And that's really the power here. Like, cards like this have historically seen some amount of play in Magic and other card games. It's definitely not unplayable. It's not just an arena card or anything like that. There's beast synergy to take into account. There's the fact that the warrior quest wants you to play taunts, for example, to take into account, right? This is a card that you can include in a few strategies that care about the taunt or the beast synergy, just to have, you know, an extra two drop or just like another reasonable play. I think for the most part, it's not going to make the cut. It's just going to be a little bit too weak, but the reason, like, the fact that it's trading one for one when they use a spell to kill it makes this card pretty attractive in a lot of ways, and you know, not completely unplayable. For the most part, though, I think it is on the weekend. We're not really going to see it played and constructed, but not because it's just the worst card ever, right? Like, the fact that it trades with one drops is bad against aggro. Like, if I trade my Flame Imp or my Enchanted Raven into this, that's bad. And I think the fact that, or like patches plus Rusty Hook charge, I think the fact that that weapons train into it, like Jade Claw, that's the other big weakness. But other than that, it's not the worst. But I don't think you'll see play. All right, then we got Volatile Elemental. This one's tough to evaluate, right? It's a two-drop elemental. Death Rattle, deal 3 damage to a random enemy minion. The fact that it's a Death Rattle and it's a 1-1 gives your opponent a lot of control over how this Death Rattle happens. Most of the time, it's going to be really easy for your opponent to mitigate the effectiveness of this card. Efficacy, is that a word? I think that for a deck like Priest, for example, if you're trying to incorporate an elemental package, maybe you want the extra 2-drop. But if you don't care about the elemental tag, I don't think this is a 2-drop that you just throw into your deck for the sake of it. I think it's not quite on that power level. It's too easy for your opponent to make it not that effective. I think even for elemental decks, you'd rather be playing other 2-drops most of the time. But it's not completely unplayable, right? It's still got a death rattle. I was thinking of playing it in like, Quest Priest, but even in a deck like that, it's like really questionable. It's tough to make that deck work, man. It's tough to make that deck work. All right, next we got Rock Pool Hunter. Battlecry, give a friendly Murloc +1/+1. This is probably like the strongest Murloc card they've printed like almost ever. I mean, this card is so busted. Okay, so Shattered Sun Cleric, when he had 3 health, was so good he had to be nerfed, and he was in every single high tier deck. And granted, minions have gotten better since then. I don't know if a 3/3 Shattered Sun would still see play today. I think it would in Zoo. But this card's better than that. Like, you lose one attack, but like, who cares about it? Attack doesn't matter in Hearthstone. It matters is health. This thing has the same health as the unnerfed Shattered Sun for 3 mana, and the same effect within a Murloc deck. That's so dirty. Like, it's totem, like, it's better stats than Totem Golem, because you're getting a 3/4, but one of your stats has charge. So you get to immediately trade up into in a trade you shouldn't have been able to do. It's so good. It's a Murloc itself. It gets buffed by like Murlocs were always a joke before because they couldn't win the early game against anything. But now every other class basically lost its early game, and then Murlocs got this thing. And this is like, this card is so stupidly powerful that it might make Murloc decks a real thing. Like, I don't give a shit about the Shaman quest. It doesn't matter. It doesn't help the Murloc deck. Even though it's like flashy and Murloc themed, like this card makes the Murloc deck good. So we'll see. Right, next we got Egg Napper, Napper of Eggs. It's a harder to ignore Harvest Golem. The raptors are beasts, I believe. It's an interesting card. It's got the death rattle synergy going for it. I was considering running this in, God, what was it like? Might have been like Aggro Druid or Quest Priest or something ridiculous. The power level is just not there. There's better 3-drops for almost every class. I don't think it's really going to make the cut anywhere. But it's like a solid 3-drop. The stats don't completely suck. That's all there is to really say about it. But in general, it's underwhelming. All right, next we got Tar Creeper, one of my favorite cards in the expansion when I first saw it revealed. When I did my original review, and still to this day, after having played for a couple days, I still think Tar Creeper is one of my favorite cards in the expansion. This is like the anti-aggro tool that control decks needed for a very long time. They decided to print it in an expansion with a billion other anti-aggro tools, and in an expansion when all the good aggro cards also rotated out. But, better late than never. It's a powerful card, 3 mana, 3/5, super constructed, playable. The elemental synergy matters. Even without elemental synergy, it's strong in a lot of decks. Tar Creeper's good, man. Just play it and stuff. This card's sick. I think it has a lot of potential moving forward. I think it's a great card, and we'll be seeing a lot of this in Taunt Warrior decks. We'll be seeing it just teched into things like Jade Druid just to help against aggro, for example. It's just a good card, man. Like, if you're having trouble against aggro, throw this in. It's like Zombie Chow that's not as bad of a top deck later on. All right, next we got Primal Fin Lookout. Battlecry, if you control another Murloc, discover a Murloc. I mean, it's just a classic case of Murloc snowballiness, where if you already have the board, all your cards are great. But if you already have the board, everything's great in Hearthstone. Which means you're winning at the game. Like, every deck's cards are good when you're ahead. Is a 3-mana draw card good enough in a Murloc deck once you're ahead? I think probably not if the stats are this bad. Maybe if it was like a 3/3. I mean, maybe the Murloc decks really just desperately need another card draw effect and they want to play this guy, but he looks really weak to me. And I think this guy needed to, like, I don't know, he just needed to be a 3/3 at least. I'm in general underwhelmed with this. I think it probably won't be good enough to make the cut, even in Murloc decks. But we'll see. All right, next we got Igneous Elemental. This card's a pretty like powerful card, but it's like not immediately apparent, right? It's not a card people get excited about when they read. In my first review, before I played with the set, I also had a good feeling about it. I liked it. I think the two elementals that you get off of this are, I don't know, they just enable so many different strategies for so many different decks, right? For an elemental-based deck, you're essentially going to be able to trigger an elemental for the rest of the game, like no problem. Not that that's a challenge anyway, but it also fills in your curve the whole time you're doing that, right? You're always going to have a way to use that extra one floating mana you have, so it plugs in the holes in your curve moving forward. In decks like Rogue, it's giving you two one-mana things to do, right, which is great for your Edwins, your Sharazins. It's just giving you like stuff to play that's pretty reasonable. And beyond that, the obvious inclusion for this card is in the Quest Rogue deck, right, where you're already playing Firefly. You can bounce your Firefly and get another elemental out of him. If this thing ever dies, you're just going off with elementals. It's just an incredibly powerful card for triggering your quest pretty reliably. You can play it in, like, okay, you can play this in Quest Hunter if you want to do that. You can play this in so many things. In Zoo, it gives you juggle triggers and all of that. It triggers your, like, Ravasaur on its own. You can eat the elementals with Pterodax. What are other synergies? In Druid, it gives you a billion dudes in play, so you can Savage Roar. Like, it's just a solid guy. And I'm not saying that it's a tier 1 card that you need to play in all those decks. The other decks usually have stronger things to play than this. But I'm just saying, like, the amount of synergies are endless, and at the very least, you're going to be including two of this in Quest Rogue. But it's a solid constructed playable card. I think it'll see play in 2017 the way that Harvest Golem saw play in 2014. All right. But not as much, because Harvest Golem's like the best card in the game back then. Yeah. Anyway, Thunder Lizard, Battlecry. If you played an elemental last turn, adapt. This card would be a lot stronger if there were stronger 2-drop elementals. Unfortunately, there kind of aren't. Blizzard kind of went out of their way to make sure there wouldn't be aggressive curve-out elemental decks, because then it would be another year of Shaman being dominant. So, because of that, you can't really trigger this guy on curve very reliably. And I think that's really going to be the nail in the coffin for him. I think on average, like, you know, he's as good as Blackwing Technician if you played an elemental last turn, but you're just unlikely to do that unless you're playing this guy in the mid game, in which case that's kind of like, yeah, mediocre, you know. Maybe there's an all-in elemental deck that just wants to, you know, play the cost reducer guy and just flood the board, though. I'm not sure. We'll see. But I think this guy's most likely not good enough. All right, next we got Giant Wasp, Stealth Poisonous. This card's insane in Arena. You know, Mulch did rotate out for Druid, so maybe it wants to be playing a copy of this card to be able to kill a big minion it can't deal with otherwise. I think probably not, but, you know, the option is there. It's like a neutral Patient Assassin with Beast Synergy. The fact that it has Stealth makes it really easy to copy with Menagerie Warden as well. It's an interesting card. You know, I think it's not unplayable, but it's unlikely to ever see playing constructed as well. All right. Next, we got Pterodax Hatchling. This card sucks. Just an arena card, you know. Need that filler. Since I mostly do my constructed review, or my review around constructed, I mostly do my review focus around constructed. I'm going to move on. So Stegadon coming up next. All right, 2/6 taunt beast. You can play this in mid-range Hunter if you really want to taunt. The stats don't completely suck. I've definitely played Oasis Snapjaw before, and it's been pretty solid. I still like Oasis Snapjaw, especially with the current 2-drops people are playing. Probably over this card, but the taunt definitely lets you stabilize against aggro decks you wouldn't otherwise be able to beat. So, I mean, it has a lot of value. It's a card that probably won't see constructed play. If it does see constructed play, it'll be in mid-range Hunter. Alright, moving on, we got Fireplume Phoenix. It's a really exciting card. It's like a neutral Keeper of the Grove. I mean, this kind of effect obliterates aggro. You get elemental synergy behind it. It's a card that I want to... Like, on paper, it looks strong enough to me to see constructed play. I don't know where. It's pretty open-ended. But then, every time I build a deck, there's like other stuff I can fit in, because there's just so many good cards, right? So many cards I want to experiment with. That this card never really quite makes the cut. But I think if... Just like the fact that it exists in the metagame means that if a deck like Zoo ever got out of hand, you have this completely reasonable neutral minion that you can include in almost anything to really help out with that matchup, right? You play this, you kill Knife Juggler, Darkshire Librarian. You're threatening to trade into Voidwalkers and stuff, so they have to trade their Flame Imp. Like, it's a good card. Like, it's a good. And even in when you put it in your deck and then you end up queuing into not Zoo, you still have like a reasonably statted guy. Like, it's just a good card in my opinion. But it's not immediately apparent where you put it right now. And next we got our Nesting Rock. If you control two other minions, gain taunt. I mean, the stats in this are pretty fat, so it's possible that you can run this in Midrange Hunter in the like Tundra Rhino Stranglethorn Tiger slot. If you're a slower list and you want the help against aggro, I can definitely see that working. But yeah, it's for the most part, I think still going to be weaker than Stranglethorn Tiger or the other 5-drop. I think that against aggro, what you're scared about is losing the board control by turn 5. And if you've lost board control, then this guy's not going to actually be getting the taunt. But you know, still has the beast synergy, still fat stats. You can still Houndmaster it even if you don't get the Battlecry. Overall, I think it's unlikely to see play. Lower power level card. And next, we got Sabertooth Stalker. God, I hate stealth as a mechanic. You're going to play a fun interactive game of Hearthstone, some back and forth. You've finally swung the board back to your favor. You're looking to stabilize and close it out over the next couple turns. And then your opponent plays this idiot. And then, like, you either have your Consecration or whatever, or you're dead. And that's kind of, I don't know. That's kind of how I feel about this card. I think it's most likely not going to see constructed play, but man. I'll get cheesed by this when they pull it off the web spinner once in a while. Yeah, I'm gonna be pretty upset. But yeah, it is what it is. You know, there's ways to interact with it because of the low health count, and yeah, it's probably doesn't have a deck where it immediately fits in. Next, we got Sated Threshadon. There aren't that many big death rattles in the game since they rotated Sylvanas out. So I mean, maybe you play this guy in an Azoth deck just to have like another copy of Cairn, but I think most likely not. Probably won't see play. Just a decent arena guy. Next we got Storm Watcher, 7 mana, 4/8, Wind Fury, Elemental. I mean, it's pretty obvious this guy's not going to see competitive play, but I don't know. Those are big stats. It's a cool effect. Just you know, decent filler guy. There's going to be a lot of those to round out the set every time. Next we got the most giant of Mastodons. The 9 mana 6/10 beast. Yeah, it's a big minion. It's got taunt. It's got some flavor text. It's got some Ice Age artwork. Not gonna see constructed play, obviously. And then we got Ultra Sore on 10 mana. This guy is a source of so many memes. I just do not know why, man. I don't get it. He's just, does he have like two heads? He's orange and stuff. Part of him looks happy. The neck thing looks angry. I don't really know what I'm looking at. I opened like 50 of these when I was doing pack openings. Disenchanted the shit out of them. That's Ultra Sword, man. It is what it is. Just a big friendly orange guy. All right, guys, that is my Un'Goro set review. Again, I'm so sorry for getting this to you later than I wanted to, and I'm sorry for making it a little bit shorter than I would have liked. I definitely think I liked my last review a little bit more. I did it when I had more energy. This one I'm doing when I've already been awake for 24 hours, and it still ended up being over 3 hours long. But yeah, thank you for watching the channel. Thank you for all your support. Thank you for subscribing. Welcome to the channel if you guys haven't been here before. And of course, if you want to support me, the team, yourselves, buy a t-shirt. Store.tempostrom.com. Buy a t-shirt, get laid, use code TEMPO. See you next time. Damn, it's a sexy t-shirt.